going to make a few opening remarks before we have the prayer. And that may, there's a reason for that, a little reason. And then our guests will make a 20 to 40 minute presentation. And then we're going to have a kind of a question and answer discussion type of thing. It won't be strictly questions and answers because we don't want anyone to feel like one question and you're out of there. You know, we want to try to make sure everyone's concerns are addressed, okay? If I could just make a little background comment to maybe place in context, at least from my perspective, where we are. Our Lady of La Salette, everyone's familiar with her prophecy to one extent or another. She said, everyone's familiar, most familiar with the line, Rome will lose the faith. But later in that prophecy, there's some very relevant things, I believe, that may apply to our day. They seem to. Such as she says, the church will be in eclipse. Now, you know that an eclipse is where the sun is there, but the moon blocks the light of the sun. But the sun is still there. And so the church being eclipsed would mean that the church is still there, I would think. Yet there's something blocking the light of the church for a time. And Anna Cantor and Emery talked about a counterfeit church. Okay? What I want to suggest to you for starters here tonight is that the reason we're here discussing extremely confusing and thorny issues, farmer friends sometimes at each other's throats, is not because anyone here decided 25 years ago that they wanted to cause as much trouble as possible, but because there was, in effect, a hijacking of the Vatican and the structures of the church, which leave us, at the moment, wondering exactly what we should do. Anna Catherine Emmerich had another vision where she saw Catholics, all good Catholics in a church in this vision, looking suspiciously from side to side at one another, not knowing who they could trust. And that is exactly the situation we're in today, as far as I can tell. So the reason I mention this is because I hope that tonight we can keep this on the level of charity to one another. I've been in a number of these meetings where there is charity breaks down to some extent. Now, I don't mean to say we shouldn't vigorously discuss the issues. We need to vigorously discuss the issue. In fact, in case anyone is wondering, let me clear up one thing. Our guests were traveling through the Midwest, to Detroit, perhaps to Akron, I'm not sure, and then down to here. It could have been anywhere, but since they were in the area, Father Dolan, I guess, was communicated with, or they communicated with someone who knew of this, and he then suggested they stop by to air all these things to those parishioners who were interested. Father Nolan asked that I moderate this, so I consented to do so, primarily out of an interest of making sure that everything got out on the record tonight as much as possible. So that is how this took place, and there's no further mystery than that. I think Fathers Dolan and Chicada are hoping that there's an airing of the issues for the laity that are interested. Father Greenwell is here somewhere, and Father Jenkins may be along eventually. Father Dolan made it clear to me, and I made it clear to everyone, that everyone is welcome, and the idea is not to have some kind of a one-upsmanship meeting, but to get all the issues discussed. Now, there are some protocol problems, and that's why we're going to hold the prayer for just a few more comments. One of the is the addressing of the clergy. One of the issues before us tonight is the is whether or not the Thuc line, Archbishop Thuc line, consecrations and ordinations are even valid. So that is an issue. So someone brought up, well, what if I don't want to address the guest as father or bishop? For my own part, I will be addressing all the clergy present in the way that they wish to be addressed. I think it's silly for us to spend all night saying, you should have called me this, you should have called me this. Bishop Pivarunas has indicated that Reverend Pivarunas would be fine with him if anyone doesn't want to call him Your Excellency. So Reverend Pivarunas, at least, I think is fair. We call the Archbishop of the Anglican Archbishop Runcie Archbishop, and he's no more of a clergyman than I am. So there's a certain courtesy involved here. I hope we can all observe. So that's one problem. certainly, again, I would reiterate, I hope there's no disrespect either of ourselves to ourselves, and especially not to the clergy. On the one hand, as far as the laity is concerned, we want to go forward with clear consciences that what we're doing is the right thing. And we don't want to desperately latch onto something that is not right, no matter how desperate we appear to be. On the other hand, if there's something that God has sent that is okay, we can't afford not to examine it closely and take advantage of whatever God may have sent that is okay. The format after these remarks, which are almost concluded, is that Bishop Pivarunas will give a 20 to 40 minute presentation, and Father Louis Kerfoot from Mount Sacrifice Michael is here. I suppose he will have something to add, and Father Thomas Fouhy is here in the front row, and I believe he will have something to add too. At that point, then we'll move to discussion. There's a temptation, because of all the controversy, that someone might want to have a great emotional outlet tonight, but I would kind of urge that we keep applause and that type of thing out of the picture tonight. All we want to do is get all the issues, give everyone a chance to speak, get all the issues out in public view with a direct face-to-face session here tonight. To lead to the prayer, we'll say the prayers all together, because there was even some controversy about that, about who should lead the prayer. So we'll say all the prayers all together. Now, as most of you know, a most tragic thing has occurred in the last 24 hours. Mr. Larry O'Ancia was struck with a brain aneurysm and has since passed away at Fairfield Mercy Hospital. Was a good friend of many of ours. I had a great deal of respect for him. And on a personal note, you know, a lot of people I've known have died either, but they're usually older than I am, a few younger than I am. There's never been a time, and I was at the hospital a little bit, where I felt, gee, you know, this could have easily been me. Any one of us could have dropped over with a brain aneurysm last night. Any one of us could have been in the hospital, and any one of us could have died. So it really hit home with me on the transitoriness of life and the and how we always have to be prepared. And I think that, you know, to reiterate something I said at the beginning, we shouldn't be necessarily wanting to shoot each other here tonight, because we're all trying to figure out, I believe, what to do in these very confusing times. But for Larry O'Ancia, the repose of his soul, and for the success of this meeting in getting out the information that we're all hoping to hear and to be presented with, let us stand and say in Our Father, Hail Mary, Glory Be, and then Bishop Pivarunas will take over the program. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
I'd like to begin by first of all introducing who I am and where I'm from. My name is Bishop Mark Pivarunas. I was born and raised in Chicago, and I joined the religious congregation of Mary Immaculate Queen in 1974. I was ordained a priest by Bishop George Musey and June of 1985, and I was consecrated a bishop this past September. When the proposal to come and speak to all of you was brought up to myself, the first thought that came to my mind was, can anything new be added to this long controversy? I am presently residing in Omaha, Nebraska, and on occasion received a correspondence from Father Kelly to Father Dolan and Father Chicada, and Father Dolan and Chicada back to Father Kelly and Father Jenkins, and quite seeing this go back and forth and seeing all the issues aired and cleared, I was in doubt whether anything really could be accomplished. But if it would be of any service to any of you, that is the reason why I come here this evening. I want to be able to address all your concerns, all the questions that come to your mind about Mount St. Michael, the Congregation of Mary Immaculate Queen. We have nothing to hide. We never have had anything to hide. And we have always spoken openly. Now, perhaps this has not been the impression that has been given by Father Kelly. And I'd like to address this primarily because that has not been the case. I remember it was approximately a year ago, or perhaps more, that Father Kelly had written me a letter. And in the letter, he had a number of questions that he was expecting an answer from myself about Mount St. Michael's and our history. And my response to Father Kelly was one of just putting him off and saying that if you were really interested, Father Kelly, in Mount St. Michael's and knowing our history, then first of all, let me tell you that I resent the fact that you wrote in the Roman Catholic about us without having first made an inquiry about our history. Some of the things that he had written in the Roman Catholic in his first article about us were not true. And so when he comes in with all these questions, I figured what would be the purpose. He supposedly is such an expert on Mount St. Michael's and our history, and he can be so sure of himself that he can write authoritatively incorrect information and then print it in the nationwide publication, and then time after, now he addresses, he wants to know information about us. I also did not want to answer his letter, secondly, because of the fact that some of our situation deals with the ordination and consecration of Archbishop Thuc. And I know for a fact, having talked to Father Francis Fenton in Colorado Springs, that Father Kelly does not recognize those ordinations or consecrations. And so I wrote to Father Kelly and I said, what purpose is it for me to write and explain anything about that aspect, our relationship with the Thuc bishops, if you don't even agree on a basic point, and that is the validity of the consecrations? And so then there was a second letter written by Father Kelly saying that if I were interested in the truth, then I would answer his questions. And my response to Father Kelly was, if I really believed you're interested in the truth, then I believe that before you would have written in a Roman Catholic, you would have inquired, first of all, the facts about our background before you have written your article. And so it is that after that our correspondence ended. But I would like to categorize what we're going to be speaking about. There's three particular areas. The first area I'd like to address is that of Archbishop Thuc. The validity of his consecrations, the rite he used, Archbishop Thuc's state of mind, and the men that he consecrated. And that is the reason why I asked Father Fouhy to come here, because I've never had the opportunity to personally meet Archbishop Thuc. I have met the men he has consecrated directly, Bishop Girard de Laurier in France, and also Bishop Moise Carmona in Mexico. There was a third priest that was consecrated, Adolfo Zamora, but he had passed away. I never had the opportunity to meet him. So during the first part of the talk, at a certain section, I'm going to stop and give the floor to Father Fouhy, who can tell personally of his observations of Archbishop Thuc. The second part of the talk will be on Mount St. Michael's, the Congregation of Mary Immaculate Queen, the history of Francis Schuckardt, the break between Francis Schuckardt and the Mount St. Michael group, Bishop Musey's involvement with Mount St. Michael's, the conditional abjurations, and the ordinations. And then thirdly, I'd like to address, this is something that perhaps is not related to why some of you came here, but I would like to address the future of all of you, and where basically you're going as Catholics. I think that I would like to address the mystery bishop that did the ordinations this past year, who this bishop is, and why is there the secrecy involved with the bishop that ordained these men? Why can't there be the openness to being up in front about who did the ordinations, the manner the ordinations were performed, and the background of the bishop that ordained these men? I think that we should come to the realization that there are certain things that you have a right to know. You have a right to know about the validity of the priests who are offering Mass for you, hearing your confessions, and ministering the sacraments. And to me, this is one of the reasons perhaps why I'm a little bit skeptical when I hear more and more about Father Kelly, and that is because on this one point alone of the bishop, this mystery bishop, the secrecy involved. If there's something to be done, let's do it out in front. Let's be unafraid of what we're doing, and let us tell the world what we're about. There should be no reason to hide. And if there's a reason to hide, I'd like to know why. With regard to Archbishop Thuc, I would like to begin with by saying that he was the Archbishop of Vietnam. He was the brother of President Diem. And during Vatican II, at the call of Vatican II, he did not want to leave Vietnam. He wanted to stay because he was afraid that the government would fall to the communists. And if he were to leave, he would not be able to return. Archbishop Thuc was forced by Paul VI to go to Rome to attend Vatican Council II. And as would be the circumstances, as soon as he left, shortly thereafter, I believe within the week, the government fell, his brother, President Diem, was assassinated, and he was not able to return to Vietnam. And then after Vatican II, Archbishop Thuc retired. Who did Archbishop Thuc consecrate? I believe that there are two basic branches that we like to address this evening, that of Gerard de Laurier, who was a Dominican priest, and also that of Bishop Moise Carmona and Bishop Adolfo Zamora. Who were the priests that he had consecrated? Bishop Gerard de Laurier was not just some ordinary priest. He taught philosophy in Rome at the Angelicum. He assisted Pope Pius XII in drafting the dogma of the Assumption. Gerard de Laurier also assisted Cardinal Ottaviani in his critical study of the new Mass. Gerard de Laurier, the Dominican, was certainly an expert in philosophy and theology. He was certainly someone to be respected in that realm. He, Archbishop Thuc, consecrated Gerard de Laurier in May 1981. In October 1981, Archbishop Thuc consecrated two priests from Mexico, Moise Carmona and Adolfo Zamora. I don't know very much about Adolfo Zamora other than he was a priest, a Roman Catholic priest for 40 years plus. Moise Carmona taught in a seminary for many years. He, from the very beginning, rejected Vatican Council II and the changes. In fact, when Moise Carmona was excommunicated by the Bishop of Acapulco, the Bishop of Acapulco was one of his students. And the interesting thing in Bishop Carmona's life is that when he was excommunicated, he wrote a letter to the Bishop of Acapulco and called him by his first name, Rayfield. Who do you think you're kidding? Excommunicating me from what? From the conciliar church, the church that I don't even belong to? He said, you are the one that's departed. But Bishop Moise Carmona, he had taught in a seminary for many years. He had been a traditionalist priest from the very beginning. He knew of my father Arriaga Sainz, a Jesuit who had, from the very beginning, attacked Vatican II and the changes in the Mass. And the reason why I'm pointing these things out is in order to get across the point that men that Archbishop Thuc consecrated bishops were not just fly-by-night people. They were very good, staunch, traditional Catholic priests. They knew their theology. I remember on one occasion, Bishop Williamson called into question by letter whether I was validly ordained a priest. And among the other things that I wrote to Bishop Williamson, I said, Your Excellency, I said, I'd like to have you know that these priests that were consecrated by Archbishop Thuc Some of them were priests, ordained priests, before some of the bishops that Archbishop Lefebvre consecrated were even born. And I don't say that by way of disrespect to Bishop Williamson, but just by way of admonition to have him not belittle the intelligence of these men. Insofar as Archbishop Thuc performing these consecrations, there's been question about what rite he used. I remember this was raised by an old Catholic priest who, among other things, was arrested for perjury. His name was Father George Perrant. He had circulated letters and tapes to this regard that Archbishop Thuc used the new rite. This was rather disturbing because I'd never heard that before, and I flew down to Acapulco in May 1987 and talked directly to Bishop Carmona. We have this on videotape. And among other things, when I asked Bishop Carmona, was the old pontifical used or was it the new rite of Paul VI? And he laughed and he said, of course it was the old pontifical. There were sworn affidavits by two doctors, Dr. Hiller and Dr. Heller, to say the pontifical, the edition was 1908 that was used. Bishop Carmona laughed and he said, I should know what rite was used. I just so happened to be there. George Perrant wasn't there, you know. I was there. Bishop Zamora and Bishop Carmona both had pontificals right in their hand as Archbishop Thuc followed the ceremony. And Archbishop Carmona said he followed exactly everything that was contained in the rite. Exactly what was contained in the rite. And so when we come to the idea of questioning the ordinations or the consecrations of the Thuc bishops, we consider, first of all, that Archbishop Thuc was a validly consecrated bishop. He had papal faculties under Pope Pius XI and Pope Pius XII. He was truly a bishop with jurisdiction in Vietnam. After Vatican II, when he retired, he did perform these consecrations, as a matter of fact. There were witnesses to that, Drs. Hiller and Heller. The men that he consecrated were priests well known for their theology and well established in the faith. They testified to the fact that the pontifical was followed exactly. And so, insofar as the doubts that come about or that are raised, the question comes in based on what? Now, perhaps some may say, well, Archbishop Thuc was senile. Maybe he wasn't in his right mind. Now, before Father Fouhy speaks about his personal observations of Archbishop Thuc, I would find it rather difficult to believe that a senile man can open up a book like the Pontifical, follow the rubrics exactly, use the exact forms to be used in the rite, and not know what in the world he was doing. I find it very hard to believe. And so at this point, I'd like Father Fouhy, if you could please take the floor and give us a little bit of your impressions of Archbishop Thuc.
Father, could you give us a little bit of your history? Because outside of my introduction, I don't think many of us know when you were ordained and so forth.
Your Excellency, fathers, I don't know how many fathers are here, sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I was ordained just 48 years ago, and I've noticed the extraordinary changes that have taken place over the last 30 or more years. So have some of you, but you haven't realized what's really involved in them. The fact is, and I think we have to get this clearly into our minds, it hasn't been mentioned yet, but it needs to be mentioned often. And that is that we have one tremendous enemy. And that enemy is none other than Satan himself. Now this is simply something that intends to be overlooked. Satan is a meanie of the worst type. In fact, he's the only one whom our blessed Lord actually defined. He said, he is a murderer, he is a liar, and the father of lies, and the truth is not in him. Bear that in mind always, because those are the words of our blessed Lord himself. Now, the point is this, that throughout the 2,000 years of the church's history, Satan has been doing his utmost to bring harm to the church. And the church in the Middle Ages reached its zenith. That's when it was really strongest and most magnificent in all of its operations. And then who should arise but one called Luther, a special friend of Satan, as he acknowledged. And he was able to bring about a great heresy. But it was a peripheral thing. It was on the outside, you might say. Nevertheless, it spread. It spread throughout Europe. It spread throughout England and so on. And eventually, of course, as a result, it arrived here in the United States. So that was a pretty big victory, but not nearly enough. And Satan kept on working for a few more centuries until at last what's happened but the so-called Council of Vatican II. I say so-called because it was no council. It was unlawful from the start. And it's very obvious from its works what it was worth. Now, he had a mighty victory there, this same Satan. He had a victory over the worldwide church and has brought about, without any doubt, the long prophesied harm that even our Lord himself referred to. He said, when the Son of Man comes, that's how he always addressed himself, will he find, think you, faith on earth? Now that was simply a reference to what we know as the great apostasy. You know what an apostate is? An apostate is a baptized Catholic who loses the faith. Take a look at the world today, ladies and gentlemen. The whole Catholic world almost has disappeared. The Pope no longer preaches the truths of his predecessors. The bishops are not even bishops. They're apostates. No one can question this. And of course, the poor priests, well, many of them today are not properly instructed. They've been instructed in all sorts of false doctrine. And on top of that, they've been ordained in a rite that is not a true, valid Catholic rite. I'm mentioning this because I want you to get this picture. The picture is that we are in the midst of the great apostasy. And what is left? A handful, no more, a handful of true Catholic people who believe the way they always believed, the way I believed, the way I was brought up, and many of you people. They, I would say perhaps we would have a great deal of trouble finding around this wide world as many as 200,000 traditional Catholics. That might be an exaggeration, but it is so important to get this in mind. Now, I only just want to, I'm here to tell you something about Archbishop Thuc. Well, first of all, I can tell you, when I met Archbishop Thuc, he was as old as I am. He was 83. And I went there, I saw him on several occasions. In fact, we went down, I went down with Bishop Vazelis and Bishop Busey to Toulon, the south of France, to see Archbishop Thuc. And he was fairly fragile, I would say, but nobody's fool. He was able to discuss with these other men very competently matters of theology and canon law and so on. And he was the most courageous man that I've seen until fairly recent times, because he was the first man who had the courage to come out and say, the seat of Peter is vacant. That is exactly the position. the seat of Peter is vacant. But he was the man who said that. I talked to him, I asked him about an occasion when he visited New Zealand, where I come from, in 1963. That was about the time, I think, that his brother, a wonderful Catholic man, was assassinated. He was the president of Vietnam. And he told me all the detail very clearly. I said to him, I remember that you visited Archbishop Liston in Auckland. He said, yes, I did. But he said, I also visited Wellington. And there I spent some time with the Archbishop, a man named McKeefrey, who later became a cardinal. He was one of the 837 bishops and canonists and some cardinals amongst them, a great number of men who prepared the schemata for the council. And he said, I knew him well because he and I were together at Propaganda Fide College in Rome. And he told me some very interesting things about Cardinal or Archbishop at that time, McKeefrey. I tell you what, he had all his marbles. He was able to think straightly. And it's a very sad thing for me to hear people making these sort of wild, unsubstantiated statements about it. It's a very evil thing, but why not? Satan's in the act. The whole purpose of Satan in our world today is to divide and conquer. Well, he's already had a victory, as I've said, over the greater part of the church. So now his objective is to work on the Catholic people. And he does that very effectively indeed through the Catholic people themselves. It's a great tragedy. Listen, folk, what we want is peace. Priests and bishops, they want peace. They should have peace. They need it. And if they don't have it, you don't have it. And these controversies are carried on amongst people. There's a great deal of pride comes into it. And there's a great deal of overheated discussion. That's no good. Look, we're here to run the church and keep it going. We don't want this sort of thing. In the name of heaven, let us give up all this controversy. And I can tell you that as far as that one issue is concerned, I have no doubt at all in my mind when I state that as far as I can judge, and from what I saw of the Archbishop, Archbishop Took, he was a very noble and competent figure. I think that's all I need to say about this issue.
Thank you. There's quite a few points that we're going to try to address, but before we carry on to the next issue, what I'd like to do is just to state, first of all, that with regard to the priests of Mount St. Michael, there are presently 13 priests, myself making 14. 11 of us were never ordained by Schuckardt. 11 of us were directly ordained by Bishop Musey or Bishop McKenna or one of the other Took bishops. Of the three who were ordained by Schuckardt, as we will get into a little bit later on, they were under condition or conditionally ordained by Bishop George Musey when he first became in contact with Mount St. Michael's. We'd like to proceed to the second part, and that is the background of Francis Schuckardt. I'd like to preface what I'm about to say, first of all, that Father Kerfoot and I, in no way, shape, or form, condone Francis Schuckardt, his immorality, or any of the bizarre behavior patterns that he had exhibited. We, both of us, are among those who have ousted Schuckardt because of his scandalous behavior. And when we speak of his background, we're just trying to basically present the facts. We're not trying to canonize him. We certainly would never try to do that. And we're not trying to condemn those things that he had been involved with insofar as those things that were legitimate. But we want to just state his background for the sake of the record to show how things proceeded where he and I became involved, and most of the religious members, the religious brothers, sisters, and priests had become involved with the organization. Francis Schuckardt was a member of the Blue Army. He was the international secretary of the Blue Army. And in 1967, when the new mass was being experimented with, he broke with the Blue Army over this very issue of the new mass. And he started what he called the Fatima Crusade. The purpose of the Fatima Crusade was to spread the message of Our Lady of Fatima, to promote wearing the brown scapular, praying the rosary, and to establish study groups throughout the country where the basic idea would be for Catholics to get together, pray the rosary, and then study their Catholic faith, and especially study those issues that were most important with regard to the church at that time in 1967. The destruction of the mass, the errors of Vatican II, and all the different things that were coming about right during that time. Francis Schuckardt was preaching in one occasion in Colorado, and when he was speaking against the changes of Vatican II, a certain priest by the name of Burton Fraser stood up during the question and answer period and asked Francis Schuckardt, why don't you proceed a little bit further, and as you condemn the new mass and the decrees of Vatican II, why don't you start condemning the heretics in Rome? And Francis Schuckardt at that time had not really confronted that issue publicly. And he asked the priest, Father Fraser, could I speak to you privately about this? Father Fraser was a friend and co-worker with Francis Schuckardt for a short amount of time. He was killed in an automobile accident, I believe, in 1971. Nevertheless, with regard to the situation with Francis Schuckardt, the difficulty came especially with regard to a lack of priests. They had working with different priests who were older, but one by one they had gone with the changes of Vatican II. And Francis Schuckardt, together with Father Fraser had done investigation of the orders emanating from the old Catholics, investigated the validity. And I know Jim Condit was asking for some type of proof about Father Francis Fraser. All that I can say is that I personally knew a woman who was housekeeper and caretaker for Father Fraser's house and apartment, and she will verify the fact that the research, she was definitely doing the research, because, and she would clean up his apartment. There was reference to old Catholics, you know, material, et cetera, et cetera. Outside of that, in anything in writing, we don't have. So just get that over with. With regard to the priest that had helped and assisted after Schuckardt was ordained and consecrated, let's get into that a little bit. Father Fraser was killed in 1971, and that same year, there comes into the scene a Daniel Q. Brown. Daniel Q. Brown was a Roman Catholic who, we will certainly not condone his activity, who out of desperation because of the changes in the church went to the old Catholic schismatic group and was ordained a priest and consecrated a bishop. We do not condone that. Period. Underline it. We do not condone Daniel Q. Brown going to the schismatics. Daniel Q. Brown, I believe, was ordained in 1969, 1970. I'm not exactly sure. However, in coming to his senses and in talking to different priests, he realized the grave mistake that he had made. And especially there was a one Father Ignatius Baran. He was a Roman Catholic priest. I know Father Kelly makes reference to Father Baran as somebody involved with the Parma de Troia group. That did not happen until 1975 or 1976. At the time that Daniel Q. Brown had gone to confession and repented of his schismatic ordination and consecration, Father Baran was a Roman Catholic priest. Father Baran heard his confession, and Daniel Q. Brown made an abjuration of error and also a profession of faith. Now, we're not saying that that was sufficient to establish him once again as a Roman Catholic bishop. We're not saying that. But he did what he could, all that he could morally speaking. I would like to also say that you have to understand the circumstances of 1971. There was no Archbishop Lefebvre, or at least he was just starting. There was no other bishops, there were no Thuc bishops. And in that situation, Daniel Q. Brown did the best that he could. And from Daniel Q. Brown, he got involved with Francis Schuckardt. Daniel Q. Brown publicly stated he was not a part of the old Catholic Church. He ordained and consecrated Francis Schuckardt in 1971. Now, we would like to also state that during this time, I believe it was right after his ordination and consecration, there were several older priests involved with the movement. There was a Father Joseph Pino, there was a Father Clement Kubisch. And I want to state this by way of trying to get across one particular point that I think is very, very to the matter at hand about our present status. And that is, when I became involved with Mount St. Michael's, we didn't have Mount St. Michael's at the time, I was 14 years old in 1972. And I'll just say this as my own experience of what was taking place. My parents, my family, we drove from one place to another in Chicago, desperately looking for the Latin Mass. We would drive an hour and a half to the north side of Chicago to go to a father, I believe his name was Leo McNamara, and from St. Adrian's, we used to attend his Mass regularly. Father McNamara died. We started going to the Byzantine Rite. But it was during this time that we were introduced into the what we call the Fatima Crusade. It was Brother Dennis Chicoine, who was assisting Francis Schuckardt at the time. He explained all that was going on in the church. Many of these things made very much sense to my parents. They were very much in agreement. They saw no one else explicitly and publicly condemning the new Mass and the modern changes. And so it was that when I first went to Idaho, I was 14 years old, and when I was there, I saw older priests there. Father Clement Kubisch was my confessor. Father Clement Kubisch was a priest of over 50 years. Father Clement Kubisch accepted the ordination and consecration of Francis Schuckardt. He put himself under Francis Schuckardt. And what I'm saying this not by way of trying to in any way justify what Daniel Q. Brown did or Francis Schuckardt did, but this is very much to the point because in order to incur a censure, there has to be the elements of mortal sin. There has to be the imputability of mortal sin. And this is something that I'm going to have Father Kerfoot explain. We have Xerox right out of canon law to explain that in order to incur a censure, there has to be imputability of a mortal sin. And the reason why I explain the background of where I came from, and pretty much it's the same for all the priests and religious, is because there was never, ever the consideration of being old Catholic. Never, ever. If there was any consideration, I would have had no part with it. We wanted to be Roman Catholics, no more, no less. That was the only reason why we were there. The three men who approached Francis Schuckardt for ordination, Father Dennis Chicoine, Father Benedict Hughes, and Father James McGilloway, those three men approached him not with the idea that he was an old Catholic bishop, but that he was a Roman Catholic bishop. And so what I'm saying is, when it comes to censure, and Father Kerfoot will go into detail on this, there has to be the imputability of a mortal sin. And that's something that seems to be the element that is not considered. Schuckardt had his problems. They were private problems, and I would like to also make a reference to something that Father Jenkins wrote. Perhaps you didn't see it this way, I certainly did. He kind of infers or implies that everyone had a moral problem with Schuckardt, and that is not true. Schuckardt had a separate residence from the seminary, and he, on occasion, would have some seminarians go to his residence, and there immorality took place. When these acts became common knowledge and known to the priest and seminarians confronted Schuckardt on this matter, and he subsequently left. And we have repeatedly denounced the immorality and any of the other bizarre things that he had done. I'd like to also say that it was during this time, too, that after Schuckardt's departure, we looked for other bishops. We did not consider going to the Society of St. Pius X, primarily because the society, we felt, was in union with the conciliar church, publicly recognizing John Paul II, and to me, as I would see it, kind of compromising. And so it was during this following year, in 1984, is when the departure of Schuckardt took place. Between 1984 and 1985, our priests began to investigate the so-called Thuc bishops. It was in 1985 that they had several meetings with Bishop George Musey. And Bishop George Musey, when he came to Mount St. Michael's, he had a public meeting with all the laity. And there he explained that he had talked to a number of other bishops and priests and felt that in the absence of the Holy See, the safest course to be taken with regard to the priest and the religious and the congregation and the community would to have a conditional abjuration of error, because there was never an intention of being anything but Roman Catholics. But due to the Brown-Schuckardt connection, he thought it would be prudent to do so conditionally in the event that possibly something may have taken place. He felt that that would be the safest course insofar as any type of penalty. He also said that he would conditionally ordain the men who were ordained by Schuckardt, those three men. And he said so because of the fact there is no Holy See to give a final decision in this matter. For this, I'd like to turn on the overhead projector and read the public statement that was made by Bishop George Musey.
Can everyone see that?
We'll read it out loud in the event that you can't. Beloved, dearly beloved in Christ, this is April 23rd, 1985. Since I was raised to the episcopate 3 years ago, one of my fondest hopes and earnest prayers has been that I might be used as an instrument by our divine Lord to help restore unity and peace in his bride, our Holy Mother, the Church. One of the greatest scandals in the church today is the division among those who call themselves traditional Catholics. How sad it is that instead of joining forces to repel the common enemy, so many traditionalists spend great amounts of time and energy attacking and finding fault with other traditional Roman Catholics. Today on the feast of St. George, a great step was made on the path of true unity among traditional Catholics. On this day, I received under my jurisdiction and bestowed conditional ordination upon three priests, members of the Congregation of Mary Immaculate Queen, based at Mount St. Michael, Spokane, Washington. These priests had originally been ordained by Francis Schuckardt, whose orders emanated from old Catholic lines. After studying the documentation that these priests presented on their orders, and after consultation with my advisors, I had little reason to doubt the validity of the orders these three priests had received. Nevertheless, since the Holy See is vacant, an authoritative and binding decision on the validity of these orders cannot be made, and mindful that the validity of these orders will always be doubtful in the minds of some, I decided the most prudent course of action would be to bestow conditional ordination upon these men. Those Catholics who have been receiving the sacraments from Father Dennis Chicoine, Father Benedict Hughes, and Father James McGilloway should not allow themselves to become troubled or perplexed on account of these conditional ordinations. Personally, I have found no reason to doubt that these men had valid orders, and I believe the church would have supplied the faculties needed in these extraordinary times. If any of the faithful are troubled, lest anything be wanting the canonical form of their marriage, they should know that I have granted a synoptio in radice, supplying any defects in the canonical form of marriage. And then he concludes with some words of rejoicing. Turn the lights back on, please. We'd like to also say that with regard to the conditional abjuration, which was taken by the priest and the seminarians, someone has raised the idea that they were made insincere because you didn't think you abjured or you had anything to abjure. There was no error involved. I can reassure you that we don't, any of the priests or seminarians for that matter, we don't take things lightly. And insofar as there may have been anything that was incurred or any penalties that may have been involved, it was with that condition in mind that an abjuration was taken and the absolution was given. We weren't up there just pretending or making a game out of it. And the same thing with regard to ordinations. You know, sometimes you have someone who may be coming from a Protestant church who feels perhaps that he has been validly baptized by his minister because the water was poured, the right form was used, but perhaps in order to have certainty in this matter, a traditional priest will say, well, in order to remove any doubt, we'll conditionally baptize. If perhaps there is a doubt, the man receiving or woman receiving the baptism certainly has that in mind. If there is anything, if there is invalidity of my baptism, I certainly want to receive the sacrament. For Father Benedict Hughes, Father Janice Chicoine, and Father James McGilloway, that was their intention. If there's something that we don't see or we don't know of with regard to the old Catholic lines, anything wanting in the validity, then we wish to receive the sacrament of holy orders. And I would like to reiterate two things here, both one on the part of the Archbishop Thuc, and also with regard to the situation with regard to orders from Francis Schuckardt. The first thing is that if anyone has a doubt about Archbishop Thuc, I would like to see it as being reasonable and positive doubt. You know, we can always speculate on one thing or another. That is frequently the case when sometimes there's speculation about the consecrator of Archbishop Lefebvre. Oculi Leonard possibly was a Mason. Could a Mason have the intention? We can speculate till the cows come home, so to speak. But that's all speculation, it's all negative doubt. And I would also say that if there is any positive doubt about Archbishop Thuc, I'd like to see it raised. And secondly, as I give the floor to Father Kerfoot, who will speak about the nature of censures, the importance of imputability of serious sin, we'd like to raise that as well. If anyone can show imputability in that sense, please, by all means, feel welcome to raise that question. Father, you want to?
My name is Father Louis Kerfoot. Just to briefly give you a little bit of my background, I was born and raised in California, attended Catholic grade school and high school there, was taught by Dominican nuns, came from a very traditional Catholic home, so traditional that I was among those abused kids who had to kneel down every night after dinner and pray the rosary. I had to get up on first Saturday mornings and drive something like 35, 40 miles to attend a traditional Latin mass in a little redwood chapel offered by a very, very old priest. I stopped going to the Vatican II mass in 1969 or 1970 while I was still a high school student because I was convinced at that point that the Vatican II mass is not a valid mass. And I was having a kind of a fight with my father because he hadn't quite got to that point yet. I went to Spokane, Washington in 1972, leaving the university or the Sacramento State University in Sacramento, California. And as the bishop mentioned, the reason why I went to Coeur d'Alene at the time in 1972 is I found the only person who at that time was saying unequivocally, the Vatican II Council is a false council. Paul VI is a false pope. The new mass is not a mass. I had been going to traditional lectures, among those Father Fenton, and I've been asking, going about, I remember going to the University of San Francisco to a lecture that Father Fenton gave. Going up just as a high school student after the lecture and saying, if there's a problem with the mass, Is it still a valid Mass? And he was saying, well, probably is, and maybe not, and perhaps, and yeah, maybe. Is Paul VI the Pope? Well, yeah, certainly. We know that for sure. He's the Pope. Well, 1972, I finally found somebody who was saying the new Mass is absolutely invalid, at least in the English rite. Vatican II is a false council. Paul VI is not a Pope. You know, people started to tell me then I was a nut. So you're a nut. Some of the same people who told me I was a nut then are saying John Paul II is not the Pope. Vatican II is a false council. The new Mass is an invalid Mass, and you're still a nut. I think there's a preconceived prejudice on the part of some people. I was in the Coeur d'Alene community from 1972, still there today. I was ordained to the priesthood in 1985 by Bishop George Musey. Since 1985, I've been working mostly in the schools and on mission work. And currently, I commute about 700 miles every weekend to go say Mass for a group of people in Tacoma, Washington. I put somewhere like 50,000 miles on the car in the last 6 months. They're not very pleased because they have to buy a new car, but they like to have a Mass on Sunday, so they're caught there. I'd like to reiterate a point that the bishop kind of touched on, but didn't really get to it. He and I are among a group of religious who had been raised as Roman Catholics and have fought very, very hard to retain the Catholic faith. When people bring up Francis Schuckardt and they say Schuckardt did this and Schuckardt did that and Schuckardt was like this and he was like that, you're not telling me anything new. We lived through that. We suffered through it. We suffered along with the people. And we took measures 6 or 7 years ago to totally change that, to totally change that. And I think that that's something that people don't realize. I think people are trying to hang us for things that we had absolutely no control over, and that when we were made aware of them, we vigorously fought them. And some of the extremes of Schuckardt, I shouldn't say some of the extremes, all the things that were extreme, we endured with, we suffered along with the people with that. I forgot to start, I was going to start with a story. You know, you're always supposed to start a talk with a story. I left school on Thursday, and the kids love to see me leave school because they know that, you know, while the cat's away, the mice will play. And I have a couple kids who are football nuts, fanatics. And they said, where are you going to go, Father? And I said, I'm going to go to Cincinnati, Ohio for a meeting. Are you going to go see the Bengals play? I said, nobody's going to go from Spokane, Washington to Cincinnati to watch the Bengals play. No offense, but that's the truth. Anyway, the bishop asked me to share a couple ideas with you about law, canon law tonight. And none of us in this room, myself included, are canonists. And I just want to touch upon a couple principles. One of the things we have to remember about law is that everybody has an opinion about law, about civil law and about canon law. If you think you have a case to bring against somebody, what do? You go down to a lawyer and he finds law that supports you. And so you sue somebody and you go into court and there's a lawyer sitting on one side of the room with law on his side. And there's a lawyer sitting on the other side of the room with law on his side. And what do? They argue it out. And you know what? Somebody then makes a decision, the judge. And the judge says, you are right and you're wrong, or he says, you're wrong and you're right. And everybody has to accept that. And if you don't like that judge's decision, what do? You appeal to a higher judge. But ultimately, you're going to get to a point where there's somebody who has authority who says, this is what the law means. This is what the law means. And one of the problems I've seen, and I think you see it, we all experience it with traditional Catholics today, is a constant kind of running to the code of canon law and picking out law at random and kind of making the law mean what we want it to mean rather than asking ourselves, what does the law really mean? And we take what is essentially a private opinion and we say, this is the opinion of the church, because this just happens to be my opinion. Could I get the lens off for a second? We could multiply texts, and all I'm going to do is just show a few basic ideas here. This is from, I don't know how to turn this on. Oh, goodness, I can't. How do you adjust this? This is from a textbook on canon law, which is just basically a seminary textbook. And you'll see right here the point I want to make, the interpretation of law. Says we must distinguish between authentic and private interpretation of the ecclesiastical law. Then it defines that. Only the following may give an authentic interpretation to law. The lawgiver himself, the man who makes the lawgiver's successor, those whom he or his successor has commissioned to issue authentic interpretations, thus the pontifical commission. An authentic interpretation has the force of law. And then it goes on and talks about authentic interpretation. What's the point? The point is there's one person who can interpret law for the universal church, and that's the sovereign pontiff. The sovereign pontiff. I am not the sovereign pontiff. I haven't met one yet. Anybody who's standing up and saying this is exactly the way it is giving you personal opinion. Personal opinion. One of the mistakes we made as a community was to take the personal opinion of one person and enshrine it. And enshrine it. And that's a dangerous error that Catholics today should not make, is to enshrine any one man, to put one man up on a pedestal and say, this man has all the answers. Anybody today, except a man who claims to be a sovereign pontiff, is giving you personal opinion. And if somebody comes along claiming to be a sovereign pontiff, we better check that one out. Okay. Let me run through this. The next point I just wanted to make real quickly was about offenses. The bishop said about censures. This is talking about crime. Okay? Over here, by crime, Canon 2195 understands an external morally imputable violation of law or precept to which a canonical sanction, whether determining or indeterminate, has been attached. Up here it defines what that means, where it says, thirdly, the transgression must have been morally imputable. In other words, the delinquent must have violated the law precept knowingly and willingly, so that if someone is going to incur a censure, if someone's going to incur a censure attached to a crime like schism, he has to intentionally go into schism. Has to intentionally go into schism. Has to be a mortal sin. Another principle when we talk about censures is a principle we don't hear much about today. That's the principle here about the benign interpretation of law. The fundamental rule here is that in paedis, benignior est interpretatio facienda. Latin would be, when you're talking about crimes or penalties, the most benign interpretation of law has to be followed. That is, of two or more probable opinions in a doubtful penal law, that interpretation must be followed, which is the milder one from the delinquent's point of view. So if you have two choices to make, either to be very severe or to be mild, the law itself says you have to take the milder course. Just two more. Just to show you how benign the church is in her interpretation of law. This is talking about accessories in a crime. Suppose you have a crime and then you have people who are accessories to the crime. They're saying that accessories do not incur the same degree of guilt as principals. And at times they can disclaim all responsibility. There's another one in there. Even if those merely facilitated the misdeed. The point here is that just because one person may commit a crime doesn't mean that same penalty necessarily passes down from father to son, let us say. Last, what I want to show you is to show you how benign the church's interpretation of the law is. When question was raised in a case like Bishop Brown or Daniel Hugh Brown, only the Roman pontiff can absolve him. Some people will say that. This is a commentary on Canon 2255, which says, when can confessors, when can a simple priest absolve someone? We all know in danger of death, in urgent cases. But this is saying in urgent cases outside the danger of death, and it gives one case, if a censure cannot be observed in the external form, or, now look at this or if it is hard for the penitent to remain in the state of grave sin for the length of time necessary for the competent superior to provide for his case, then any confessor can absolve in the sacramental form from the censure, no matter in what way reserved. No matter in what way reserved. A further commentary on that same point over here, where it says the urgent case. What does an urgent case mean? It may mean here. The penitent may find it hard to remain in the state of mortal sin until recourse for absolving faculties is obtained from the competent authorities. Authors claim that a delay of one day suffices, so that the latter will conceive the hardship of remaining in mortal sin even for one day. So what I'm trying to get across here is the idea that the church says we interpret law in a benign way, we interpret penal law in a benign way. The church says in order to incur a censure, there has to be serious sin, seriously imputable sin. In interpreting a censure, you interpret it in a benign way for the delinquent. And then also the church is saying any confessor can absolve from it if it's a burden or a hardship for the penitent. One last thought. When I deal with problems in the current state of the church, I try to take an analogy. And one analogy I have been thinking about when you talk about canon law is the analogy of the Mosaic law versus the new law. Remember when St. Paul started to preach to the Gentiles? All the Jewish converts to the Christian faith said those people have to be circumcised. They have to follow the Mosaic law first, then they can become Christians. And St. Paul has a beautiful quote. He says, why do you try to bind on somebody else something that you don't fulfill yourself, that you can't fulfill, that your fathers found it difficult to fulfill? My question to you, my dear people, is name me one traditional group in this country or in the entire world today that follows canon law to the letter. One. Nobody does. You know why? Because as Father Kelly himself says in the Roman Catholic, you can't follow it today because of the times. You can't follow it today. So what do? We interpret it according to the circumstances we're in, and at best, whoever does the interpretation, at best, the interpretation is private, it's not authentic, it's not the church's interpretation, it's the private interpretation of a priest. Okay? Thank you very much.
We'll hand the floor to you because I'm afraid that we've gone way over the limit.
Oh, okay, that would be, I think we can work in your third thing in the questions and answers. Okay. What I'm going to do is leave the house microphone in the hands of our guests. I am going to stand at the podium, though you're more than welcome to stand up, for two good reasons. One, I want to see who wants to talk, and so we can get everybody in. And two, I'm going to repeat the question into the microphone so that anyone listening to this at a future date can figure out what the man is. The person from up here is trying to answer. I may be a little bit like Larry King, if you ever watched him, and sometimes will kind of rephrase the question because he thinks he makes it clear. Now, if I don't make your question clear, you stop me right away, okay? Who's got a microphone? I don't think this microphone helps. Can you not hear me? Okay, fair enough. Did everyone hear what I said? More or less? Hopefully less, I guess, but okay. Who wants to ask a question? If not, I have a few myself that I will begin with. Does anyone have something that pops to mind here? Okay, let me just start the ball rolling. Could I ask this? You said, Reverend Pivarunas, that you did not condone the taking of orders from Daniel Q. Brown, who was an old Catholic who went to confession, etc., for Bishop Schuckardt being ordained and consecrated by him. Do you condemn
that act. And if you would answer briefly, then I have a follow-up, and then you can answer as long as you want, okay?
I condemn the act of Daniel Q. Brown going to an old Catholic, yes.
Okay, do you condemn the act, just so we're all clear, of Daniel Q. Buff Schuckardt taking orders from a man who was consecrated by an old Roman Catholic line?
Objectively speaking.
Objectively speaking, I'm in doubt about that matter. I am in doubt because of the fact that, insofar as Francis Schuckardt was concerned, he himself felt that due to the circumstances of the destruction within the church and not having any bishops, traditional bishops, of recourse to, he assumed, applying the principle of epikaia, the interpretation that the lawgiver in this circumstance does not in any way intend to bind when the strict fulfillment of the law would become burdensome to the faithful. He assumed that, and that's the point that I would say is at least doubtful.
Okay, if I could follow up then, and this is the last part of this, if that is the case, and if we can apply epikaia, the question I think everyone here is wondering is, where do we draw the line on this thing? When Archbishop Thuc or Archbishop Lefebvre ordains and consecrates, at least there's a bishop who was appointed under a true pope, Pius XII. If the principle that you just stated is correct, what would stop me if I looked at all of the traditional priests and said, this is a mess. Everybody's arguing with each other. I don't really like any of them. I'm married and I have six children. But what if I went to an old Roman Catholic bishop and got myself consecrated, a priest on Thursday and a bishop on Saturday, which is not too far what Bishop Schuckardt from what Bishop Schuckardt did. And I came back to you and said, I've just found a traditional priest and I went to confession. And ladies and gentlemen, I am ready to serve your needs as bishop and priest. What would be a matter with that based on the principle? This is a real concern I think many people have. In other words, the floodgates are open to anything.
Yes, I would say that in that case, I would say that in your going to an old Catholic bishop, you would be going to him as such as an old Catholic bishop. Or you're going to him as an old Catholic. He is an old Catholic receiving orders from him. When Schuckardt went to Daniel Q. Brown, he had gone to confession, and there was at least some attempt to do something in some what he attempted to make a Catholic manner. And what I'm saying is that with regard to the difference, with regard to the ordinations and consecrations of Thuc and Archbishop Lefebvre, true enough, they were Catholics, and the ordinations are valid. They themselves did not possess any authority. They themselves, by consecrating bishops, were also applying a principle of epikaia by the consecration, because strictly speaking, they themselves would have needed a papal mandate to consecrate as well.
I'd like to comment further on that a lot has to be considered in light of the circumstances at the time. The times we're speaking of, the 1970 era, there was no Archbishop Thuc on the scene, there was no Archbishop Lefebvre on the scene. They were not standing up and saying, the Mass is destroyed, Vatican II is a false council. We didn't have priests. It's not like it is today where you have priests and you just might not like the priest. It was a matter of there were no priests who were coming out forthrightly and saying, the Mass is destroyed, Vatican II is a false council, this man is a false pope. They weren't there. So I think it's kind of hard to say what would that same principle apply today. I don't think it would apply because the whole situation has changed. You do have bishops, you do have priests on the scene now, which in that time we didn't have.
Okay, now just because we pass on to another point doesn't necessarily mean that I agree with all the ramifications of what is said or that I disagree, but we'll move on. If anyone has anything, then chime in. Could I say one more question on this? At least all the traditional priests that I know apply extremely rigorously the principle that if you are in a bad marriage, you, Mr. John Q. Traditionalist, are in a bad marriage and the marriage goes sour, that they will not grant an annulment because there is no legitimate authority to decide on it. Now my question is with Bishop Daniel Q. Brown. He was from an old Roman Catholic, not lying. Nobody disputes that. If no annulments can be granted because there's no authority to accept them, how can who is the authority that allowed Bishop Brown to exercise his orders
In other words, since there wasn't no authority, wouldn't it follow that what he did was a sacrilege, what Schuckardt did was a sacrilege, and everything stemming from that is schismatic and must be avoided?
I thought you were, so I wasn't really thinking about it. But first of all, I'd say this, and we'll just stand up. There's a difference, I think, between an annulment, which is a jurisdictional act, saying in the external form, these two people seem to be married, so we're going to break that bond, that apparent bond. There is no bond. That's one action. There's a different action of a man coming to confession for a sin. Now, if his orders are valid, he is a bishop. He is a priest. Faculties do not empower you. Faculties remove a restriction upon your power. In other words, when I'm ordained a priest, I have all the power I need as a priest to act as a priest. What the church law does is the church law restricts my use of that power, right? So what a bishop does is the bishop gives me faculties and he says, okay, now you can use that power. Daniel Brown could operate, I think in good conscience, he could say, I'm operating under the implicit powers which the code gives, which priests use today. I don't know any traditional priest today who has faculties. What do they work on? They work on the powers they have as a priest and upon the implied permission of the church. And I think, again, you're going back to a situation not where you have priests and bishops you can choose to work with, but in a situation where there were none.
Does
the schism can? No, I don't think. Under the law of the church, you incur a censure for your actions if those actions are a matter of serious sin and they violate the law of the church. Just because someone would be ordained by Brown or someone ordained by them, that doesn't pass down. Schism, you know, when we talk about a crime, schism is a very narrowly defined crime, and you have to commit that crime.
Okay, does anyone else, have we lost everyone? Does anyone else have any questions, or should I continue? Could you identify yourself and please speak?
Priest of the congregation where I just came here, because I came late, I was asking if the question addressed, though, as far as I know, to my knowledge, before the consecration took place, there was a public declaration on the part of the ground.
We mentioned that.
But in lieu of times, in light of times, I think it's close, but without an absolute authority, what is someone to do? I mean, who is around to give them entrance into the church? Because I think the very fact that most of us have ceased to go to Novus Ordo, we don't recognize that as a Catholic church.
What would you say to someone who said, okay, maybe this is possibly, maybe would be okay, but I have a serious doubt, therefore I don't think I can attend the Mass of anyone that associates with these priests who came into being through a schismatic line? In other words, a doubt. Don't we have to be certain when we go to the sacraments that we are not participating in schism or in any kind of an invalid sacrament?
What we are saying is that with regard to Francis Schuckardt, Francis Schuckardt could be the devil incarnate, as far as I know. What Francis Schuckardt is doing right now, I really don't care. I guess the question comes in, the priests, we can name all 14 of them, the religious, the laity, who were involved, did they incur a censure? That is the essential matter at hand. Did they incur a censure? And if a censure was incurred, that it needs to be proved.
I would also say that my approach to this is that I had someone come to me in Seattle a couple weeks ago, a little old lady, and she'd heard about all this confusion. She came up to me after Mass and she says, Father, I want to say something to you, but I don't know how to say it. And I said, well, just say it. She says, I just hope you're a validly ordained priest. And I kind of looked at her and said, I hope so too. Just went on, you know. I'm not telling you in this room you have to come to my Mass. If you don't want to come to my Mass, fine. I'm a priest, I'm here to serve. If people want to come to my Mass, fine. And I don't think it's up to a priest to say, you have to come to my Mass. I don't believe that. And I'll tell you, I've been through an experience like that before, and I don't like the experience. And I think the priest, no priest today has a power to command people in the sense that pastors before did. So as far as people saying, well, I can't come to your Mass, I would say, if you have a doubt, you should try to resolve the doubt.
Father, stay on that point for a moment. I went to two of Schuckardt's priest gatherings in Cincinnati during the 80s, okay?
Early, when he was still around. When he was still around.
No, he wasn't there. It was Father Maria Barnes and Father Maria Benedict, I believe. Both of them said at the end of their speech, if anyone who wants to come to our Mass and go to communion must go to confession to us, take an abjuration of schism, heresy, and scandal, and promise to not go to the Mass of any other priest but in our group. Would you address that? You kind of did, but I just don't make it explicit.
That was one of the aberrations of Schuckardt. And he was saying, yes, he was setting himself up eventually to be a little pope. And he was saying, you have to accept me. And we've totally renounced it.
So you would not tell people or urge people not to go to Father Kelly's Mass, for instance?
Absolutely not.
You would not urge people not to go to Father Dolan's Mass?
Absolutely not.
Okay. Kathy Camp, finally, it's a question from the floor.
Is there any validity to Father Kelly's point that, let's just say for the sake of argument, you fellows had some taint of schism on you, and our priest was using your altars and you had used our altar? Would we have any taint of schism in that if we received communion from our priest? I mean, this is what he was trying to say. Anybody who goes to our priest because he was friendly with you and exchanged altars, we are then somehow getting tainted with your schism.
Well,
I mean, how does that work? I mean, is that a legitimate question?
You know, you can't be a little bit of schism and you can't be tainted with schism. It's like being a little bit pregnant. Either are you not. If you're in schism, you are in schism. And like I said, schism is a formally defined crime. You know what Schuckardt would do? Schuckardt would throw out these things and just talk off the top of his head. I've told people, everything I say, if we disagree on it, I'll pull out a book, I'll pull out a good author, and I'll show you why I'm saying what I'm saying. Schism is a crime. It's a narrowly defined crime. Okay? I have never been in schism. I was born a Roman Catholic. With God's grace, I'll die a Roman Catholic. I did not leave the Vatican II Church when I was 16 years old, to become an old Catholic. That's stupid. I'm a Roman Catholic. I always have been. And I pray God I always will be. I'm sure the bishop says the same thing. So when people say, well, you know, you're tainted with schism, they may have doubts. Fine. People can have doubts. People come up to me and they say, you know, Father, I'm not comfortable with this. Fine. Just try to resolve the doubt. Just try to study it and see what these terms mean.
I'd like to pose the question, too. I'd like to know about Bishop Mendez. Bishop Mendez, I believe, was the one that ordained the two men priests, and also that was the third part that we were going to talk about, but we went over time. But Bishop Mendez, I believe, is very much a part of the conciliar church, very much a part of Vatican II Church, and insofar as the idea of keeping it a mystery, maybe he doesn't want to get in trouble with Rome, but I think maybe that's one of the reasons why the name hasn't come out. Who received his abjuration? I mean, was Bishop Mendez a part of the conciliar church? Does he espouse the Novus Ordo? I'm under the impression that he does offer the Novus Ordo, that he was a fundraiser for Notre Dame. You know, he's very much a part of the modern church. That also, he was so much of a part of the modern church that for at least one of the ordinand, there was a parasolic ordination of omitting some of the minor orders, or perhaps of the diaconate. Possibly, I'm under this impression, and if that is wrong, I'd like to have that pointed out, because that's exactly what Paul VI had abolished, the minor orders and the subdiaconate. I'd just like to know that.
We're going to get back to that, I promise. I wanted to follow up with one other thing. If you want, Raven, and you can feel free to ask me any questions,
sure,
too. I'm not trying to dominate this in any way. Getting back to Kathy Camp's question, what if we knew, and Father Dolan is not doing this, but let's say that Father Dolan or any other priest was saying Mass on every Wednesday at a Greek Orthodox schismatic church, and he then came back to St. Gertrude. would we not then have a responsibility to avoid going to communion to Father Dolan? Again, he's not doing that, but I'm posing the question because what concerns me about all these answers is it seems like the gate is open so wide that there's almost, it's all because there is a vacancy in the Vatican, it's almost to the point where you can't go in the schism anymore.
I want to answer this with law because somebody's going to say that guy is liberal. So let's look at the law.
Maybe someone in the back could find out how to turn up the lights.
This is from the Code of Canon Law. I lost my reference. Canon 2261. Now this is on excommunicated persons, okay? Except, it says, except in the cases mentioned below, the faithful may, for any justifying reason, seek the sacraments and sacramentals from an excommunicated person, especially if other ministers are not available. The excommunicated person thus requested may administer them with no obligation to inquire about the reason for the petition. So let's say Father Dolan does that, which I never believe he would, but let's suppose he does that. Can people go to him? Yes, they can. Can they stay away from him? Yes, they can. Do they incur some kind of a censure because they go to his mass? No. Because the Code of Canon Law, Canon 2261, says the faithful have the right. Now, don't say they have to do it. No, they don't have to do it, but they may approach them. When may they not approach? Only in danger of death may the faithful seek from excommunicated persons who must be avoided, somebody formally excommunicated by Rome, by name, or from others whose excommunication has been pronounced in a declaratory sentence. So that answers it. May you? Yes, you may. And is the door wide open? Yes. And that's the punishment. You know what we're trying to do? We're trying to live in the great apostasy as though this were 1955 times. These are not. These are the great apostasy. Are there false priests running around? Yes, there are. Are there priests whose doctrine is not quite sound, or people, or priests are a little bit off? Yes, there are. Yes, they are. But just because somebody does something wrong doesn't necessarily mean you have to, that you, I shouldn't say allow, I should say it, that you may not approach them and receive the sacraments. You have the right to, you may. Now, that's where the informed decision comes in. There are priests that if people come to me and say, what about this priest? I say, well, you can go to him. I've got a problem with part of his theology. Does that kind of make sense?
It's an answer. My brother informed me that I'm getting so impressed with my own questions that I'm missing some people out there who want to ask one. And there he is, Mr. Deese.
Jim, I would just like you to follow up on a question that you asked. You said, well, should we go to Father Dolan from the Ashton side? Should we go to Father Jenkins? And you said yes to both of these. Perhaps your answer here has already answered the question I'm going to ask, but could we go to the Society of Pius X priests?
My personal opinion on that is that they say a valid mass. If people ask me, what do I think? I say there's a problem with faith for me. Because on the one hand, they're saying, this man is the Pope, but I can do what I want. I don't have to obey the Pope. Now, I don't believe that. There's a dogma of the Church called the primacy of the Roman Pontiff. Not infallibility, primacy. As Roman Catholics, we're bound to obey the Pope. We're bound to obey him. And you cannot sit there and sift out what you're going to believe, that what you're going to obey and what you're not going to obey. So if somebody says, can I go to a Pius X Mass? I say, you have that right. I won't deny you the sacraments for doing it, but in the sermons, this is something to watch out for.
We say it's permissible, but we don't encourage it.
Follow up.
Then, what would your recommendation be if there were Father Dolan, Father Jenkins in the city, and also the Society of Pius X?
I would say you would have a better choice with going with someone whose theology is Catholic, which would not be the Society in the sense of the papacy and the primacy.
I'm trying to get a specific answer.
Well, I mean, I would say, if you ask me, is Father Jenkins a Catholic priest, I would say yes. Is Father Dolan a Catholic priest? Yes.
Now the next question.
Which you're trying to say.
I'm trying to hammer away on the Society of Pius X.
The question.
At the same point you mentioned. You walk into the chapel, there's John Paul II, there's Archbishop Lefebvre, side by side. And the same consistency that you're talking about some of the logic, I think some of us are concerned about.
What we're saying is we can't forbid you to go there.
Okay, time out. Can I repeat for the, I'm forgetting to repeat the questions. Mr. Nace is asking, I think you're asking, are the priests of the Society of Pius X, in your opinion, Catholic priests, and therefore can we go to them to Mass? Is that what you're trying to say?
Well said.
Okay.
I would say that implicitly they're denying the primacy of Peter by their position of saying he is the Pope and we believe that he is infallible, and then the other hand, trying to accuse him of all the different things that he's done. Now, the point that we're trying to make, though, is that given the circumstances, especially some of my parishioners where they travel, where they're in a position where there's absolutely no one else to go to, I believe that they can avail themselves of the sacraments with the condition or the warning that some of the things that they are saying we don't believe are totally orthodox, I mean totally Catholic. But I wouldn't, strictly speaking, forbid them.
Could I follow up a little bit, getting a little narrower now? In light of all the confusion that you've talked about, a priest or a layman that recognized John Paul II as a true pope, do you believe that they are no longer Catholic if they have that opinion in these times?
I think that we have to make a distinction. I think that there's a lot of people that err in good faith, that they don't know. I'll give you an example, and this is a personal example with my grandmother. She did not like the changes at all. She did not like the new Mass. She did not like all the changes that came about. Nevertheless, her dying words were, to me, be a Catholic and never leave the church. I knew she was dying praying her rosary, and she didn't know where else to go. And I think that there's a lot of people that don't understand all the theology that's behind it. They're not. If you ask them, do you deny the papacy? No. Do you deny the primacy? No. Do you deny infallibility of the Pope or of the Church? No. Many of these people, these things are far beyond them. And I will let God be the one to judge.
So your answer then, if I could restate it, tell me if I'm doing you a disservice here, that a Society of Pius X priest who's in good faith and recognizes John Paul II in these confusing times is still a Catholic.
I would say that in the sense that John Paul II is not the Pope. That's my private and personal opinion. I believe that someone who recognizes him as the Pope is in a contradiction, especially a priest who's supposed to be informed is in a contradiction to his belief in the papacy. I would have to say that in this matter of, it gets into the matter of how does the Pope lose the papacy, that's a matter of opinion. St. Robert Bellarmine expressed five different opinions with regard to the papacy. His opinion was that a manifest heretic, by the very fact, loses the papacy. There is also another opinion saying that the Pope would have to be warned and then removed. This issue of the Pope is not an easy thing to resolve.
So you would say then that the Society of Pius X priest, who in good faith recognizes John Paul II, is still a Catholic. I'm just trying to get a clear yes or no answer on the, or a yes or no, or I don't know on Mr. Deese's question.
I can give you my opinion. I don't believe that that they are Catholic in the sense that they. And now let me qualify that though. I know of society priests, I know of a certain priest in England, Father Gregory Sims, who believes John Paul II is a manifest heretic. And as such, he privately holds that he's not a pope. The idea, if somebody, now you're asking if somebody explicitly says, yes, he is the pope, is the man a Catholic? I would say, in my mind, it depends on the degree that he is trying to deny the infallibility of the church, and in that sense, yes, he would be a heretic.
But you would not forbid people to go to the Pius X masses over across the river here?
Well, I would say that they could if they wished to go.
Okay. Okay, now we're starting to get some hands up, and let me try to go in order here. we just touched on something. I want to ask after, right now I'd like to ask people, I see the hands that are up. Does anyone want to address the Bishop Gonzalez, Bishop Mendez issue from the floor or not?
I'd like to know why not.
Yeah.
Okay, let me be, so we don't get, I think it would be unfair to the to Bishop Pivarunas to let this point go any further before we get to your questions. Let me try to do a defense. I do not know personally whether it was Bishop Gonzalez, Bishop Mendez. I do not know. I said it quite forthrightly. I do trust the priests involved who did it. So I believe that those who are ordained are priests. That's my personal opinion. I could be wrong. I don't think I am, but let me...
So you're going to base your faith on men's and one or two people's opinion?
Well, let me raise this, and then you can respond to it, because I want to defend this secret ordination at this point, or private ordination, I should say, secret to some of us, in the same way that you've defended, that yourselves have defended other things, and that is... If a man is a bishop before the changes started, if he is willing to follow the traditional rite, despite his personal sins, past, present, or future, if he wants to be Catholic, even if he's a weak man and maybe has vacillated, then provided he is a bishop and he did do the rite, wouldn't it be safe to say that the men ordained were certainly Catholic priests?
Well, I think there's a distinction to be made. We have, in the case of the Society of St. Pius X, men who have explicitly denounced the changes of Vatican II, are not offering the Novus Ordo Missae, and have made a definite stand. I believe that they are mistaken with regard to their position, with regard to John Paul II. I don't believe that there is the external wish to deny the papacy. But on the other hand, I'd also have to say that with regard to Bishop Mendez, I am under the impression that he did and still does perhaps offer the Novus Ordo Missae. He has done an occasion for weddings. And so far as the very secrecy or hiddenness of this, he didn't want to incur anything from the Rome or the authorities of Rome. I would say that in a sense, the distinction is that the society priests, and I don't wish to defend them because I don't hold to their position, but I would have to say that they have made a clear-cut break with Rome, etc. Whereas Mendez is as I believe one priest put it, kind of Benedict Arnold, so to speak.
Could I just follow up there, though? But if we are going to be lenient on Bishop Brown and Bishop Schuckardt, wouldn't we have to extend the same leniency in light of a ruling from the Holy See to someone such as Bishop Gonzalez or Bishop Mendez?
Could I kind of respond to that? Please. I would say I would extend the. I would give the benefit of the doubt if I knew who I was giving the benefit of the doubt to. But to say broadly, I don't know who I'm giving. I mean, we're dealing with suppositions here. And if people are saying to me, Father, you might be in schism, so I'm not going to come to your Mass. To me, I think they have to be consistent with their standard and say, okay, well, I'm going to verify everybody today. Because like I said, Francis Schuckardt was first ordained by Bishop Brown, you know, we were told, this is an old bishop, he doesn't want his name revealed because he's in danger. And we bought that for a year and a half, 2 years or so. That's what we were told. You know, Francis Schuckardt left, he came back. I wasn't there at the time, I came about 6 months later. But still at that time, when I first came, we were told this was a Catholic bishop, there's no problem with it. So I trusted people too, and people stand up and say, you're not a priest and you're in schism and you went through this whole schism. Well, I didn't do anything wrong, except that I trusted somebody.
If I could follow up one other thing on that in defense of, let's say it's Alfredo Mendez for the moment. In communist countries, there were secret ordinations because people were afraid of getting killed. If a bishop in today's rather ecclesiastical, terroristic atmosphere where they may suffer all kinds of censures, maybe they're a very old man, even though we may think it's cowardly, is there any reason, if it was Alfredo Mendez who did these ordinations by the traditional rite, is there any reason to doubt the validity of those just because he was afraid to run into censures?
No.
Okay.
No. My doubt is on, if I'm going to publicly function, somebody comes to me as a priest, says, are you a priest? I'll dig out my ordination certificate, show you the day, who did it, who was there. You can check it out. And I think this is something you have to do today. people come to lectures we give on the message of Fatima, and they say, Father, I don't believe anything you're saying. You know what we say? Fine. Do two things. Pray the rosary every day and check it out. Check it out. Don't believe what I say. One man stood up and he said, you know, here you tell me the Pope isn't the Pope, the Cardinals aren't the Cardinals, the Bishops aren't the Bishops. Who are you to tell me that all these people are wrong and you're right? And said, I shouldn't. You go check it out. I don't think, you know, check it out.
Okay, now we'll probably come back to this. You can keep the microphone. We'll probably come back to this point. Now let's try to roll through the people that have raised their hand. Jason, you're taken care of through that exchange. Mrs. Wagner.
Jim, you played the devil's advocate in defending the other side of the ordinations and everything.
Which side?
The Jenkins side.
Okay.
Okay.
The other side.
Why then, that's how it's...
I understand. I just want
to... Why do we in Sharonville always have to give the consideration when we, this past summer or fall, you know, it was the final blow of the split of everything with in community with, you know, and maybe if the bishop and father could address that, you know, from another point of view other than Father's Kelly.
Okay, I think your question is why does Sharonville always feel like they're second-class citizens and have to give the benefit of the doubt?
We're the ones that are wrong, and that's obvious. You know,
see, in the eyes of the Father Jenkinson.
Right.
Okay, can I speak for myself? I give the benefit of doubt to all sides as much as possible. The reason
I'm not addressing what you did.
Okay.
I'm saying that's always the mode of operation.
Right. Before the clergy answers here, there was a Dr. Mara who came through town, and somebody asked him why he wasn't writing for a certain paper anymore, and he said the rule is I get along with everybody, nobody gets along with me. So I think sometimes all of us will find that to be the case, and we've got to be very lenient in these times, because I don't doubt that Father Jenkins holds sincerely his position. I've heard him. Yet I disagree with him. Yet I disagree with him at the moment. Yes, Bishop and Father, you want to respond?
Kind of way I would respond as one as a little boy sitting on the porch, these non-Christian neighbors would walk by and yell, "You dirty Catholic, you dirty Catholic," and I'd say, "You dirty such and such," and my mother is on the porch right now, paddling me. I said, but they said, she says, "You're a Catholic, you can't say that." So we have to sit on the porch where these people walk by and say, "You dirty Catholic, you dirty Catholic," and that's part of being Christian, I guess, is you just have to take the lumps and be charitable and give people the benefit of the doubt.
Did anyone over here have their hand up that I missed? Father Greenwell, did you have your hand up at one point, or are you okay?
I had my hand up when we were talking about the old Catholics.
Okay, we'll get back. Let me move to you in just a second. Back to
Elsa
Bowman over here.
I want to finish this, what you mentioned.
You didn't get.
Well, no, okay. You know why, Marilyn, you think that we are acting like second-class citizens. And I hate to say we and them. It's awful. Because, you know, we are all Catholics. And we should forget those tiny things. It's that we forget charity. Is to have charity is not to be a second-class citizen.
No, my real question was,
we forgot to turn the other cheek, and we are doing it, and we have to do it, and everybody has to do it, but we have to love each other, and we are not doing that.
No, my question is the communion with issue not, I just prefaced it with that. I don't care about the other stuff.
You're saying, what about you wanted to know what do the clergy here think of Father Jenkins and Kelly saying that those who go to communion with Father Nolan should not go to communion with Father Jenkins? Okay, there. Is that
a
third question?
I think it's an inconsistent thing that they do. I know of a case, Father Mario Blanco is a priest in Seattle, Washington. He says a Latin Mass there. Bishop McKenna has been out to confirm the children for Father Blanco. Father Blanco went on vacation or someplace. Father Zapp came up and said Mass for Father Blanco. This was 6 months ago. Now, Father Blanco's in communion with Bishop McKenna. So why can Father Zapp go there and say Mass for him? Isn't that communication, whatever? You know, I don't think it does. I don't think that's the way it is. And what I would urge people to watch out for is control groups. People saying, this is the way you have to do it. Anybody who comes across you and says, I think the bishop would agree with me, the priest from Mount St. Michael's, the nuns would agree with me. You know what happened when Bishop Schuckardt left? My view of the Catholic Church went from this to this. I realize there's a lot of things Catholics can believe. Catholics can disagree about things. You know, and I think some priests are saying, no, my way is the only way. And that's why they say, well, this taint of schism and all this stuff, because they're saying, I have the truth. I don't believe there's any one person here in the whole world today who has all the truth, except those things which are revealed, dogmas.
Before we get to Father Greenwell, I want to raise and we have Sean Murray after Father Greenwell. I want to bring up one point that really bothers me about a lot of the traditional clergy, and I'd like you to respond. And I don't want to get into this subject because we'd need to have 8 hours to get into it, but when the thesis was surfaced that Cardinal Siri had been elected Pope perhaps before John the 23rd, one common denominator of almost every traditional priest I knew was to immediately condemn it without even investigating it, which, to forget about whether Siri was elected or ever or anything like that. This was very disturbing to me. On the one hand, we're saying John Paul II can't be the Pope. On the other hand, here comes, well, gee, someone was elected before John the 23rd, and all the traditional priests just immediately couldn't care less about investigating it, with very few exceptions. My question is, isn't our only hope of ending this bickering and returning to certainty of mind is a restoration of the normal operation of the papacy and the Holy See? Isn't that our only hope to end all of the bickering such as we kind of have going on in a high-class manner here tonight?
I believe that, you know, if we go back to the history of the church, you have in the Great Western Schism a tremendous division within the church of great magnitude where three men were claiming to be Pope. And this situation didn't go on for just a year or 2 years, it went on for some 25 years. And I think it was due to just to the total frustration of the Catholic faithful and clergy that two of the men were forced to step down, the other just stepped down of his own accord. And then they were left with a mess. They didn't know who the cardinals were, legitimately appointed cardinals. They weren't as sure who the legitimately appointed bishops were with jurisdiction. They weren't sure of a lot of things. The one thing they were sure of is that the church has the right to have a head, and they provided for the emergency of the time, and they set down some definite rules about who would participate in the election of Martin V. Now, what I'm saying is that I think that true ultimately we need a pope to resolve a lot of these issues and to create unity. On the other hand, I believe that this is something that we should still nevertheless try to work for. We shouldn't just throw up our arms and say it's impossible because there's no Pope.
And do you believe there's any other possible solution other than the restoration of the papacy or the second coming of Christ to resolve this confusion we're in?
Personal discussion among the clergy. We've had priest meetings at Mount St. Michael with other priests, those not at Mount St. Michael, including priests who recognize John Paul II as the Pope, Father Leonard Giardina, Father LeBlanc from Phoenix, other priests. And it's interesting because with the discussion, they come to the realization of a lot of the points that we start to realize we have a lot of things in common. There's a lot of things that we can agree to. Maybe some things that we don't there may be some things we disagree on, but those things are matters of opinion that we need to work at and continue to discuss.
I don't mean to appear to be a badger here, but could I just follow up one more time on that? Do you think there's any other hope to resolve all these questions other than the restoration of the papacy and a true pope, again, operating as we were used to before 1958?
Yes.
Father Fouhy.
Yes, I believe that there is an alternative.
Mic's on.
Clip your mic.
There we go.
I believe there is an alternative, and that is that the bishops of the Catholic Church today, those who are valid bishops, and I believe that these men are valid bishops. There's no question about it. There's been no mention whatever made here of the ex obre operato effect of the sacraments, which means that when a valid bishop, like for example Archbishop Thuc or Bishop Carmona, or now Bishop Pivarunas, any others you like to mention, when they exercise an act of ordination or consecration with the intention of doing what the church does, that takes effect. There's no question about it. This is the basis of all the sacraments. Now, the result is that if these bishops get together and agree amongst themselves that there has to be a line followed that they all agree with, this stuff can all disappear. I'm quite convinced that a lot of the debate that's been going on is really, it's not a solid debate at all. You take, for example, this question of going to the Mass. All the lay people need to know is that a priest is a validly ordained priest. That's all. Now, who's going to tell them? It's not for them to decide. And this is the thing that's made such a mess in the church of today, that everybody, many, many anyway, lay people, think they're canon theologians. They pick up things, and this is where all the mess is. That the control of the church still has to rest with the bishops in unison. And please God, that will come. There was another point I want to mention, if I may, and that is the question about going to Mass on Sunday. It is for the bishops to declare who is a valid priest and who may say Mass. Nobody else. The priest can't do it. That's why you've had all sorts of rummies running around. A man that I worked with in England a few years ago as a brother turned up in the Midlands there as a priest. He was no priest whatsoever. It has to be, they have to get the evidence clearly before them, and then they can say, yes, this is a priest. And now, if a bishop states that this priest is valid and has authority to go out and preach and say Mass, people have an obligation to go. This business of deciding, well, I'm not going to go, I don't believe in this priest. Listen, the going to Mass on Sunday is a divine command. Remember, thou keep holy the Sabbath day. And it's also the most important command in the church to attend Mass on Sundays and holy days of obligation. I think people need to watch out about this. And some of the, an instance come to my mind recently, my notice, where a priest has a difference of opinion with certain priests. And he says to these people, you don't go to their Mass. That priest has to answer to Almighty God for a grave sin. His emotions are not a reason why people should not go to Mass. Look, this obligation is a very grave one. That Catholic people have to go to a valid Mass on Sundays. That's providing they're, of course, within a reasonable distance. So I think this point needs to be brought out. It's not for people to decide, well, I'm not sure whether this fellow's a Catholic. If the bishops say, and they're the ones responsible, no priest should be given permission to say Mass unless the bishop is sure that he is validly ordained and that he is within his rights telling him to say Mass for the people. But I do want to make this point because it's very important. For my own part, when it comes to all these different groups of men, different priests, I'd say drop the matter altogether. You're not going to settle it because there's nobody to settle it. Not even the groups of priests of the bishops themselves can really settle that. But any of these men that are validly ordained, let them say Mass, and please go to that Mass and stop quibbling about schism and all these other things and heresies. And this is a big mistake. Regarding those two bishops, now listen, if they were validly consecrated, ordained and consecrated, they're both important issues, then the ordination that they will carry out, if it is done with the true pontifical, those men are validly ordained. And we know this sort of quibbling has to stop, for heaven's sake. Already, the church, as I've said, has dropped down to maybe 200,000 people around the whole world. 200,000. 25 years ago, 30 years ago, at the time the council started, there were some 500-600 million Catholics around the world. So you can see what's left there, and we've got to be careful that this sort of childish debate which is so prevalent and so sickening and so unsolvable, stops, because otherwise the church is going to fall down. There's going to be very few people left. And the children of today are not going to get the benefits of the Catholic faith.
Thank you, Father. Father Greenwell has been patiently waiting to bring up something about Old Roman Catholicism. Incidentally, ladies and gentlemen, I think we're going to go, and I ask you all to kind of hang in here if you can. I think we're going to go 30 more minutes. 10:30, we'll say a prayer and give everyone an opportunity. Try to hang in it if you can, because everyone should go home and pray about this, and I would urge you to stay and witness whatever else is brought up if you can. Father Greenwell.
As far as Father Zapp or Father LeBlanco?
Blanco
in California. All of the priests of the Society of St. Pius V have taken a resolution, including Father Zapp, not to give communion to the Mount St. Michael people or to those who go to the masses where St. Michael people receive the Holy Eucharist at the same communion rail. So, in fairness to Father Zapp, I don't know all the circumstances which you're talking about, but in fairness to Father Zapp for the faithful, I think you have to give him benefit of the doubt or call him. If any of you wish his number, I will get it. And if you find out contrary information, I would like to know it. I would be happy to give anyone Father Zapp's phone number, and you could ask him if he will give communion to the adherents of Mount St. Michael, or if he will give communion to those who go to churches where the priests back up to Mount St. Michael. In fairness to him and in fairness to us, I think you should follow through with that.
Father, after this meeting and what they've went over, you still agree with that position that
no.
you just said?
Let me repeat the question. Mr. Bergman is asking whether Father Greenwell still agrees with the resolution of Pius V to refuse communion to Mount St. Michael people even after this meeting.
Yes.
Answer is yes. Okay.
Do you really?
Use the mic, please. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, Sean Murray. We'll get back to some of these things. Were you done, Father, or not?
I would like to point out what I was planning on mentioning.
Go ahead.
We all accept the glorious St. Pius X, all of us, as a great champion against the liberals and against modernism. This same saintly pope condemned our own charismatics and all who cooperate in any way with his actions. Give assent to counsel, is that correct?
Let me restate. Go ahead, read on. Go ahead.
How can we then refuse? We see clearly the mind of the Church of Pius X. How can we refuse today to follow those who condone? How can we refuse to follow those? To follow St. Pius X's condemnation of those when he orders to chase down through a Schuckardt?
If I can restate the question is Pius X. Condemned the schismatic line that ended up to be Schuckardt, and there are still three priests from Schuckardt operating at Mount St. Michael's. The question, I think, is in that decree, he says, anyone who gives any aid or any comfort to Matthew Arnold whatsoever is also condemned. And that seemed to me to be a fair reading of that Pius X's decree. So isn't anyone who is participating with priests stemming from an old Roman Catholic line in violation of Pius X's decree?
Absolutely not. I'll tell you why. Number one, I'm missing something. Maybe I'll find it. I love Pope Pius X. He's a saint, yes. He's anti-modernist, yes. He condemned Matthews, the whole thing, fine. That was in 1910. The new code of canon law came out in 1917. We're bound by the new code of canon law. And the new code of canon law says something specifically. And this is the exact same, this is the exact kind of thing I'm talking about, passing something along. There is nothing in the code of canon law which says that an excommunication is passed on like that, nothing at all. There is an ipso facto excommunication by a bishop who seeks consecration without the mandate from Rome. There's no excommunication for a priest who in good faith goes to that bishop thinking him to be a Roman Catholic bishop. when I allow Bishop Schuckardt to ordain me to the minor orders, to the subdeacon and the deacon, I went to him because he told me he was a Roman Catholic bishop. He said that, I am a Roman Catholic bishop. And I accepted him as a Roman Catholic bishop. And I have received orders as a Roman Catholic. I in no way participated in Matthews. Matthews was over and done before I was born. I was born in 1953. The Matthews thing occurred in 1910. And the Pope is talking about those who took part in a specific action. The code specifically says an excommunication does not flow. It's not an open-ended deal. Certain persons are excommunicated right now.
Father Greenwell. It's not just a question of excommunication, but you also have the question of the irregularity. Does not a priest who goes to a schismatic to receive orders automatically incur irregularity? Please answer that.
Fine.
Okay, the question is, does not a priest who goes to a schismatic to obtain orders incur irregularity?
Fine, but I'm trying to find something here, if I can find it. Our whole relationship with Bishop Brown, or Daniel Q. Brown, was on predication that he was a Roman Catholic, not that he was an old Catholic. We, before, when he first...
Sure, lights off again, please.
When, I'll tell you how our connection with Brown started. In 1969, the Wanderer, many of you know, did a real smear on us, the Coeur d'Alene group. You know why? Because we said Paul VI was not the Pope. We said the Vatican II Mass is not a Mass, Vatican II is a false council. You know what they said? You're in schism. You're outside the church. Okay? We got a lot of bad mail because of that. People said, well, we don't like your position. We're going to hit you where it hurts. We're going to stuck. Francis Schuckardt. We are Roman Catholics, nothing more, nothing less, who are forced by circumstances to function temporarily without a pope. We follow the doctrine, dogma, and liturgy of the Roman Catholic Church. Our holy orders are descended from the Church of Utrecht, Holland. We are not schismatics, apostates, heretics. On the contrary, we look forward to the day when we can be united with a valid holy see. We are not in communion with any other church or denomination. Now, whatever Brown did, when he presented himself to us, he said, I am a Roman Catholic. We worked with him on the assumption that he was a Roman Catholic. Also, to show you the point we're trying to make, this is a letter that Brown wrote to the Coeur d'Alene Press, which was the local press, where he restates those. Now, this is a copy, but it is signed by him down at the bottom here. This is April 14th of 73. He says, first of all, I am not an old Catholic bishop. It is true that I was consecrated a bishop in that church, and validly since the Roman Catholic Church has accepted them. However, to avoid any connection with schism, I severed all ties with the old Roman Catholic Church before consecrating Schuckardt. He says, that was in here, he says something about abjuration, but I guess it's another letter. But what I want to make is a point here. We never worked with Brown thinking that he was in schism, ever. And we worked with him on the assumption that he was a Roman Catholic. Father, or his Excellency just showed me from the commentary in the Code of Canon Law, Canon 986 says, an irregularity cannot arise except from a crime. And the crime has to be a willful action. So people just don't become irregular at the drop of a hat. There has to be a crime there.
There's two types of irregularity. There's one like crime, there's one that's automatically a part of the nature of which would be something like being born illegitimate or whatever. But one is by defect and the other is by crime.
I must say, if we have the lights again, that the first letter from Bishop Brown there was standard fare, though, of old Roman Catholics. This is one of the things that concerns me, anyway. A lot of the old Roman Catholics, now that there is confusion in the Vatican, say, oh, gosh, we wish we had a pope. And you wonder if they're sincere, because they know darn well there's not going to be a pope next week or the week after. So this is why there's some concern over
okay.
the whole, that over what may be coming across, Father, as a not quite clear-cut willingness for you to objectively condemn Schuckardt's actions.
To object to, I can condemn something in an abstract. To condemn a specific action, I have to be inside of a man's brain and know what he's thinking. And I'm willing to give the benefit of the doubt to anybody that I'm not going to climb inside their brain and pretend to know what they're thinking. People will say, was Schuckardt's orders and all this? I know of people who died with the sacraments because of what he did. Now, I know God will allow evil to draw good from it. What I'm saying is, I'm not claiming to be a pope. I'm not claiming to stand in judgment and say this was an act of schism. I'm willing to give them the benefit of the doubt, while at the same time I say, no, you cannot go to a man who's in schism and receive orders.
Okay. Father Greenwell, then Sean Murray, go ahead.
It is correct that you cannot judge a person unless the fact of something being done has objectively been proven, which is the case here. Then once, as the moral theology books, Joan and Primer, then once the act has been proven to be done, you had to presume that he had the intention of doing what he did. And see, you're not making the distinction to the faithful here.
No, I think I did, because I said...
Do I have the floor, Mr. Kermit?
Yeah, well, go ahead and finish. And I got to summarize it so it's in the blank. Go ahead.
You have to distinguish to them between subjective and objective truth. Quite subjectively, I have no doubts, subjectively, to the Mount St. Michael people. I know many of them to be good people, God-loving people, God-fearing people, raising their kids in home study, family rows and night. But objectively speaking, once the fact of something has been done, you have to presume the intention was there in the external forum.
In other words, the question is, some of us are wondering if there doesn't have to be a clear-cut, condemnation of the objective act of Schuckardt, and without judging his heart.
Why?
Well, for the benefit of people who might be tempted to take similar actions in the future.
Okay. I've stood here tonight and said, I am a Roman Catholic. I was baptized in the Roman Catholic Church. I went through Roman Catholic grade school. I went through Roman Catholic high school. I stopped going to the Vatican II Mass in 1969, 1970, so I could save my faith. I never in my life received orders from an old Catholic. If he was an old Catholic, he didn't tell me about it. For me to be in schism, I have to know that. Now, why is it important for me to make a judgment on that man? I don't think I have the right to make a judgment. I can judge a case. I can say, yes, a case is wrong. But I can't go to a specific man and judge him unless he makes his conscience clear to me. I can say objectively something you do is wrong. I can look at an action, I can say the action objectively is wrong. But to say it's a sin for you, to say I have to know more about it, I have to be inside of your head to do that. I will admit that going to an old Catholic is wrong. If Schuckardt did that, if Schuckardt said, I'm going to Brown as an old Catholic to get orders, that's wrong, and I reprobate that. Did he in fact do that? I don't know. And I think you'd have to be inside of the man's head to find out exactly what he did. Brown had, now, was it a mistake? Possibly, sure, okay, it was a mistake. But what my point, my dear friends, is one of the Society of Pius V priests asked me this same question 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I said, okay, worst case scenario. Schuckardt went to Brown, pulled out a checkbook, said, I want to be a bishop, how much is it going to cost? And he writes in the check and he gets ordained and consecrated the same day. Suppose they break every law doing it except the fact that he's valid. How does that affect me today? How does that affect me? I've been ordained not by Schuckardt, I've been ordained by Bishop George Musi. I stood before you and what else can I do except to say, I've come through a Catholic background. If I made a mistake, if the bishop has made a mistake, if the priests and the nuns here have made mistakes, we've certainly atoned for it in the 14 years that I was under Schuckardt. I assure you, I've atoned for it. And that's what I'm saying. And I'm saying people are latching on to that argument because they don't have a better one. And the argument is not Brown. The argument is not Schuckardt. The argument is the Tuck ordinations right now, the validity of these orders right now. What are we doing right now? You know, people will go back and they'll say, well, this is what happened 20 years ago. I never knew Brown. I never met Brown. I was a latecomer. on the scene. And nobody here is stopping to talk about what has the community done since then and what apostolic action is the community pursuing right now. And I think that's a point to be addressed.
Okay, Father Bieber, one more and then we'll go. Yeah, go ahead. Father Bieber, one more to follow.
It's true that no one can call in, as you said, into the mind of someone to know what they're doing. As you're probably more aware of than I am, the church does not judge the internal. She has to judge what the person is doing on the external. That's all that I'm saying, and that's what
we have. Do we have the church to do that judgment?
The priests have to judge whether something, all of us, as a great champion against the liberals and against modernism, this same saintly pope condemned our own charismatics and all who cooperate in any way with his actions. Give assent to, counsel, is that correct?
Let me restate, go ahead, read on. Go ahead.
How can we then refuse? We see clearly the mind of the church in the highest attempt. How can we refuse today to follow those who condone? How can we refuse to follow those? To follow St. Pius X's condemnation of those when the orders are traced down through Schuckardt.
If I could restate the question is Pius X condemned the schismatic line that ended up to be Schuckardt, and there are still three priests from Schuckardt operating at Mount St. Michael's. The question, I think, is in that decree, he says, anyone who gives any aid or any comfort to Matthew Arnold whatsoever is also condemned. And that seemed to me to be a fair reading of Pius X's decree. So isn't anyone who is participating with priests stemming from an old Roman Catholic line in violation of Pius X's decree?
Absolutely not. I'll tell you why. Number one, I'm missing something. Maybe I'll find it. I love Pope Pius X. He's a saint. Yes. He's anti-modernist. Yes. He condemned Matthews, the whole thing. Fine. That was in 1910. The new code of canon law came out in 1917. We're bound by the new code of canon law. And the new code of canon law says something specifically. And this is the exact same, this is the exact kind of thing I'm talking about, passing something along. There is nothing in the code of canon law which says that an excommunication is passed on like that. Nothing at all. There's an ipso facto excommunication by a bishop who seeks consecration without the mandate from Rome. There's no excommunication for a priest who in good faith goes to that bishop thinking him to be a Roman Catholic bishop. When I allow Bishop Schuckardt to ordain me to the minor orders, to the subdeacon and the deacon, I went to him because he told me he was a Roman Catholic bishop. He said that, I am a Roman Catholic bishop. And I accepted him as a Roman Catholic bishop. And I have received orders as a Roman Catholic. I in no way participated in Matthews. Matthews was over and done before I was born. I was born in 1953. The Matthews thing occurred in 1910. And the Pope is talking about those who took part in a specific action. The code specifically says an excommunication does not flow. It's not an open-ended deal. Certain persons are excommunicated right now.
Father Greenwell.
It's not just a question of excommunication, but you also have the question of irregularity. Does not a priest who goes to a schismatic to receive orders automatically incur irregularity? Please answer that.
Fine.
Okay, the question is, does not a priest who goes to a schismatic to obtain orders incur irregularity?
Fine, but I'm trying to find something here. If I can find it. Our whole relationship with Bishop Brown, or Daniel Q. Brown, was on predication that he was a Roman Catholic, not that he was an old Catholic.
Okay.
We, before, when he first...
Sure. Lights off again, please.
When, I'll tell you how our connection with Brown started. In 1969, the Wanderer, who many of you know, did a real smear on us, the Coeur d'Alene group. You know why? Because we said Paul VI was not the Pope. We said the Vatican II Mass is not a Mass. Vatican II is a false council. You know what they said? You're in schism. You're outside the church. Okay? We got a lot of bad mail because of that. People said, well, we don't like your position. We're going to hit you where it hurts. We're going to stuck in your money. So among all the letters, we got a letter from a man who supported back to him, Francis Schuckardt. We are Roman Catholics, nothing more, nothing less, who are forced by circumstances to function temporarily without a pope. We follow the doctrine, dogma, and liturgy of the Roman Catholic Church. Our holy orders are descended from the Church of Utrecht, Holland. We are not schismatics, apostates, heretics. On the contrary, we look forward to the day when we can be united with a valid holy see. We are not in communion with any other church or denomination. Now, whatever Brown did, when he presented himself to us, he said, I am a Roman Catholic. We worked with him on the assumption that he was a Roman Catholic. Also, to show you the point we're trying to make, this is a letter that Brown wrote to the Coeur d'Alene Press, which was the local press, where he restates those. Now, this is a copy, but it is signed by him down at the bottom here. This is April 14th of 73. He says, first of all, I am not an old Catholic bishop. It is true that I was consecrated a bishop in that church, and validly since the Roman Catholic Church has accepted them. However, to avoid any connection with schism, I severed all ties with the old Roman Catholic Church before consecrating Schuckardt. He says, that was in here, he says something about abjuration, but I guess it's another letter. But what I want to make is a point here. We never worked with Brown thinking that he was in schism, ever. And we worked with him on the assumption that he was a Roman Catholic. Father, or his Excellency just showed me from the commentary in the Code of Canon Law, Canon 986 says, any irregularity cannot arise except from a crime. And the crime has to be a willful action. So people just don't become irregular at the drop of a hat. There has to be a crime there.
Types of irregularity, there's one like crime, there's one that's automatically a part of the nature of which would be something like being born illegitimate or whatever. But one is by defect and the other is by crime.
I must say, we have a light scan, that the first letter from Bishop Brown there was standard fare, though, of old Roman Catholics. This is one of the things that concerns me, anyway. A lot of the old Roman Catholics, now that there is confusion in the Vatican, say, oh, gosh, we wish we had a pope. And you wonder if they're sincere, because they know darn well there's not going to be a pope next week or the week after. So this is why there's some concern over okay. over what may be coming across, Father, as a not quite clear-cut willingness for you to objectively condemn Schuckardt's actions.
I can condemn something in an abstract. To condemn a specific action, I have to be inside of a man's brain and know what he's thinking. And I'm willing to give the benefit of the doubt to anybody that I'm not going to climb inside their brain and pretend to know what they're thinking. People will say, was Schuckardt's orders and all this? I know of people who died with the sacraments because of what he did. Now, I know God will allow evil to draw good from it. What I'm saying is, I'm not claiming to be a pope. I'm not claiming to stand in judgment and say this was an act of schism. I'm willing to give them the benefit of the doubt, while at the same time I say, no, you cannot go to a man who's in schism and receive orders.
Okay. Father Greenwell, then Sean Murray, go ahead.
It is correct that you cannot judge a person unless the fact of something being done has objectively been proven, which is the case here. Then what, as the moral theology books, Joan and Primer, then once the act has been proven to be done, you have to presume that he had the intention of doing what he did. And see, you're not making the distinction to the faithful here.
No, I think I did, because I said...
Do I have the floor, Mr. Cummings?
Yeah, well, go ahead and finish, and I gotta summarize it so it's in the mic. Go ahead.
You have to distinguish to them between subjective and objective truth. Quite subjectively, I have no doubts, subjectively, to the Mount St. Michael people. I know many of them to be good people, God-loving people, God's fearing people, raising their kids in home study, family rose tonight. But objectively speaking, once the fact of something has been done, you need to presume the intention was there in the external forum.
In other words, the question is, some of us are wondering if there doesn't have to be a clear-cut, condemnation of the objective act of Schuckardt, and without judging his heart.
Why?
Well, for the benefit of people who might be tempted to take similar actions in the future.
Okay. I've stood here tonight and said, I am a Roman Catholic. I was baptized in the Roman Catholic Church. I went through Roman Catholic grade school. I went through Roman Catholic high school. I stopped going to the Vatican II Mass in 1969, 1970, so I could save my faith. I never in my life received orders from an old Catholic. If he was an old Catholic, he didn't tell me about it. For me to be in schism, I have to know that. Now, why is it important for me to make a judgment on that man? I don't think I have the right to make a judgment. I can judge a case. I can say, yes, a case is wrong. But I can't go to a specific man and judge him unless he makes his conscience clear to me. I can say objectively something you do is wrong. I can look at an action, I can say the action objectively is wrong. But to say it's a sin for you, to say, I have to know more about it. I have to be inside of your head to do that. I will admit that going to an old Catholic is wrong. If Schuckardt did that, if Schuckardt said, I'm going to Brown as an old Catholic to get orders, that's wrong, and I reprobate that. Did he in fact do that? I don't know. And I think you'd have to be inside of the man's head to find out exactly what he did. Brown had, now, was it a mistake? Possibly, sure, okay, it was a mistake. But what my point, my dear friends, is one of the Society of Pius V priests asked me this same question 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I said, okay, worst case scenario. Schuckardt went to Brown, pulled out a checkbook, said, I want to be a bishop, how much is it going to cost? And he writes him a check and he gets ordained and consecrated the same day. Suppose they break every law doing it except the fact that he's valid. How does that affect me today? How does that affect me? I've been ordained not by Schuckardt, I've been ordained by Bishop George Musi. I stood before you and I'm what else can I do except to say, I've come through a Catholic background. If I made a mistake, if the bishop has made a mistake, if the priests and the nuns here have made mistakes, we've certainly atoned for it in the 14 years that I was under Schuckardt. I assure you, I've atoned for it. And that's what I'm saying. And I'm saying people are latching on to that argument because they don't have a better one. And the argument is not Brown, the argument is not Schuckardt, the argument is the Tuck ordinations right now, the validity of these orders right now. What are we doing right now? You know, people will go back and they'll say, well, this is what happened 20 years ago. I never knew Brown, I never met Brown, I was a latecomer on the scene. And nobody here is stopping to talk about what has the community done since then and what apostolic action is the community pursuing right now. And I think that's a point to be addressed.
Father Bebo, one more, and then we'll go. Yeah, go ahead. Father Bebo, one more follow.
It's true that no one can call in, as you said, into the mind of someone to know what they're doing. As you're probably more aware of than I am, the church does not judge the internal. She has to judge what the person is doing on the external. That's all that I'm saying, and that's what
we have the church to do that judgment?
The priest has to judge whether something is dangerous to their flock or not.
Could I ask one question? Your judgment, is that a private judgment or is that the judgment of the church?
It is a judgment based upon the principles of the church.
That's not what I ask. Is it a private judgment or is it the judgment of the church?
It's not an authoritative judgment because none of us can make that authoritative.
So it's a private judgment?
I guess so.
How do you then, on the basis of your private judgment, forbid people to say sacraments? It's not a matter of dogma. It's a matter of private judgment.
Also, the modesty with which one comes to the communion rail is a matter of private judgment, too, with the priest. It will differ from priest to priest. The priest has the obligation to make sure that the faithful are properly disposed to the sacraments.
That's not the issue. The issue here is your private judgment that people will not adhere to.
Okay.
No, I was just going to say, let me move around. I think we got that. But you're saying that...
We didn't get
that. Oh, I'm sorry. What's the matter? Who needs to answer what?
Well, I think it'd be good to make that plain. I think he's saying that that's your private opinion. And yet, we're going to deny the sacraments to the faithful because of that opinion.
Okay. What else do we have to do?
Well, we can be charitable.
What else can we do besides follow our conscience that dictates us and remind of the church as churches? We can't appeal to authority. All that we have is the private judgment.
Okay. Well,
could I illustrate this? I started a mission in Grand Rapids, Michigan. A lovely woman who came to me after I explained this whole thing, what I think about the Pope and the whole deal, she said, Father, she was almost in tears, she says, I can't buy that on the Pope. I just don't believe that. So I said, well, do you go to the Vatican II Mass? No. Do you obey the local bishop? No. He's way off base. So I said, I'll give you the sacraments. Because my view of the Pope is a private opinion. If she's not going to the Vatican II Mass, if she's not exposing herself to danger of the faith, I don't see the problem. I would like to say in simple justice, I don't have to prove I'm a Catholic. I have a baptismal certificate that has my name on it. Somebody has to prove I'm not a Catholic. Somebody has to come up and say, you are in schism, and show me the definition from the book, not just a definition that somebody made up. I was baptized a Catholic as an infant. I went through Catholic grade school, Catholic high school. I am not aware of the fact that I incurred a censor or anything at any time. And I have to be aware of it. That's what the law says. So if a priest is going to say that I incurred a censor, he has to prove the fact that I did. And if it's a dispute over, well, what did you know at the time? I'm telling you right now what I knew at the time.
Okay, I'm going to move on now for this reason. Admittedly, Father Greenwell could come up here and take the mic and address, but the clergy here is on the hot seat in a certain sense, and we can't get diverted into Pius V defending themselves for everything they've done. It seems to me that there's a lot of latitude for opinions on all these things, and that's why I'm reluctant to condemn any of the factions if they're doing it in sincere conscience, because there's so much confusion. Sean Murray.
Reverend Greenwell has said that society has resolved an issue. In other words, we have resolved not to allow the people from not St. Michael's to receive communion. I myself have been told privately by him that I would be refused not only Holy Communion but also the sacrament of penance because he would doubt my sincerity. Simply because Father Dolan happened to be at Mount St. Michael's at one point for the community. Now, you talked about certain people and control groups. Would you consider Father Kelly almost setting up a mini hierarchy with his society?
To tell you the truth, I never met Father Kelly. All I know is what has been told about him. I didn't make a statement in my letter to him for nothing when I compared him to Schuckardt in a sense of being very domineering, very controlling, very demanding, expelling people, expelling his own priests. They have to either accept his viewpoint or they're out. In that sense, I think that that's the way he sounds. I never met him before. Okay.
Since Father Kelly isn't here, I'm doing now with 10 minutes left, everyone is getting their hand up. I have to kind of go in order. This lady right here.
I want to know the obligation of a priest when he goes to a group to say mass, and how many people do they have to be there for him to say mass? And now, is it an obligation for him to say mass whether there's one person there or 20?
Is there a number obligation for a priest to say mass?
Well, in moral theology, it says, at least for a priest to binate, it says that it should be either a Sunday or holy day of obligation. It should be at least 20 people there. I mean, that's...
Well,
but on the other hand, I would not hold it against a priest.
This was a small group, which was always a small group, and it happened to be on Christmas. And this, the, a lot of them had gone away because they didn't even know it was going to be, there was going to be a mass that day. And when he got there, he wouldn't say mass for the family, which even there and a few other besides.
Well, I think under the circumstances, I personally wouldn't have a problem with a mass for a smaller group because of the times.
Right. Those people all missed mass.
Yeah.
It was Christmas.
Sounded like.
That would have been serious to me.
Sounds like. Go ahead.
I never heard of it before, and I was offended even hearing it.
Sounds like you should have said mass for that family, especially if you traveled all that way. Jason, Jason Miller.
Based on what we've already heard here so far, for example, the conversation about whether or not John Paul II is a pope, it's a private opinion, therefore you cannot force it upon the faithful, and you cannot refuse somebody from being on those grounds. But we've also heard that it is a theological opinion concerning the situation with Mount St. Michael's. If people are being refused communion, then in the various churches, based on that private opinion concerning the schism of those who attend Mass at Mount St. Michael's or were ordained or consecrated or anything else involving Mount St. Michael's, if people are being refused communion based on that private opinion, then could it be said that those people are, that those priests who are denying that communion then are actually refusing to be in communion with other valid Catholics? And if they are refusing to be in communion with other valid Catholics, is that itself not an act of schism?
Okay, the question is to repeat it, that the definition of a schism is that one of them is that to refuse to be in communion with other Catholics and is not, I suppose you're getting at Father Jenkins' announcement that he would not give communion to those that go to Father Dolan's communion. Would that not be an act of schism in itself? So,
well, I think that we have to look at it in this sense, and this gets back also to the question of Mr. Nice about the Society of St. Pius X. I think the problem that comes in with regard to individuals and the stand that they take it, they're all trying to be Catholic and they're trying to follow some principle involved in making their decisions. I believe that Father Jenkins, if he sincerely in his heart believes that somehow the group is schismatic and there's communicatio in sacris and he's doing, I mean, that's what his conscience tells him. In conscience, what he is saying is just according to what he feels in his mind, and he's trying to follow his conscience. And in that sense, I would say that is to the degree that he follows his conscience, I mean, he has to.
Who's that, Father?
Jenkins.
Father Jenkins, okay. Sir, you right there. Yes, you.
My name's Matt Davis, and I know Mount St. Michael's priest. I heard a lecture in 1982 in Columbus, Ohio. And I've been associated, I even lived there during the time of the breakup, so I know the conditions and everything. And they were kind of chaotic, but they have done all in their power to correct and ratify the problems. I've also met Father Greenwell and Father Jenkins. I've had lengthy talks with Father Jenkins at St. Clair's in Columbus, Ohio. And we were denied the sacrament of Holy Communion because we would not deny the legitimacy and the validity of His Excellency, Father Brooks, and other Mount priests. And frankly, the ladies getting sick of being caught in the middle when we have to go to work and fight all the problems there, that we pray to Our Lady that, you know, this bickering and stuff stops. But have you really had enough? You know?
Okay, thank you. To now, Bernie Brueggemann and Bobby Frito, I have to go in some order here to have some semblance of fairness. Go ahead.
I don't think that what I have to say, Jim, would be, I could classify as a question.
Make it a statement then.
My wife and I, back years ago, with a group of people around Fort Mitchell, joined the Fathom of Cell movement, which was by Francis Schuckardt, and everything in those studies was strictly Catholic. I can certainly sympathize with the statement that Father made there about trying to be Catholic, being baptized and live in a Catholic faith and die a Catholic. And I think in that sense, His Excellency, the priests that are our guests here, are certainly a credit to the church that our Lord Jesus Christ established
and certainly a credit to that priesthood. Thank you.
About me, Friedel.
My question should be fairly short. It's my understanding that if I went to a priest to be rebaptized, he did not have, he had no serious doubts as to the validity of my baptism, that he could not rebaptize me even conditionally without communion sacrament.
If he had the intention not to receive the sacrament because he strongly felt that he had already received it, and to do that would be a sacrilege.
So,
I would say, now let's get back to the issue of Father Benedict Hughes, Father Dennis Chicoine, and Father James McGilloway. They did not receive it. They did not go through the ceremony sacrilegiously. It was their intention to whatever doubt there was existing about the ordination, they wanted to receive valid ordination, period.
But you took it out and reordained?
No.
I'd like to comment on that. No, you cannot reordain someone. You can conditionally ordain them. Father Fouhy will back me up because I had traveled with Father Hughes and Father Chicoine down to talk to Father Fouhy and Bishop Busey at the time. And Father Fouhy was the one who threw the question out to us and said, would you men be willing to be conditionally ordained? And we said, why? And he said, because of your past, people are going to have a hard time accepting the orders. So we did something that I think, and I'm not blowing my own horn, I think it was an act of humility to stand up and say, for the good of the people we're going to serve, we're going to accept conditional ordination to settle this problem, because there's nobody who can settle the problem. Also, what are we left it with? We're in an unconscionable problem, that we have orders that are always going to be open to doubt. So now to settle that, there is no Holy See. You can't draw an analogy and say, well, in normal times we'd go to Rome. If we were in normal times, none of us would be in this hall. We'd all be home. We're not in normal times. And you have to do the best you can do in the circumstances that you're in.
Okay, everyone is getting busy at near the end of the time here. Mr. Benzel had his hand up, and I have a few more, so I can go.
Make a statement first. We're lucky here to have about six choices to match. And they're all valid reasons. There's no reason why I can't go where I choose. But you could like look at this aspect. Maybe I want to go where it's least resistance, where I'm least condemned. No, I have one question. I spent my mind all evening. You were consecrated, actually, by Mexican bishop.
It was Bishop Carmona.
Did the United States would accept, like, Bishop McKenna?
Pardon me?
Would you accept Bishop McKenna? Why did you have some bishops in the United States for the consecration?
Well, the issue is that even among the traditional bishops, there's different opinions. Bishop McKenna's of the opinion that was espoused by Bishop Gerard de Laurier of the John Paul II being a material pope without the authority. And because of that different opinion, we had worked with Bishop McKenna, but the issue was is that Bishop McKenna's viewpoint on canon law and on many other aspects of the church is not our opinion. It was rather difficult to have recourse to someone who's not thinking and along the same lines. Bishop Carmona, we had been in contact with him for many years. I used to go down, and we have sisters down there in Mexico assisting Bishop Carmona. And we go down there, and we could see eye to eye on every point as far as our opinions. And Bishop Carmona was of that opinion. We don't think John Paul II is the Pope. And the canon law is binding, except for as it can't apply. And if it can't apply, then we feel that through intrinsic cessation, it wouldn't bind if it wasn't for the common good.
Okay, Tom Bees and Father Greenwell, and then I think I'm going to have some wrap it up, and then we can continue after that. Father Kerfoot is also going to say one of the things after those two questions. Go ahead.
Thank you, Jim. I'd like to repeat just the point Your Grace, that you made before,
sure,
and then to confirm that from Father Jenkins' very lips himself. I believe there is a resentment somehow that we feel that a priest with a private opinion is setting himself up as an authority over us, and we heard the repartee back before. And you said before, Your Grace, that you believe that if Father Jenkins or Father Kelly are in attempt trying to follow their own conscience on the matter and believe in themselves and their own heart and their own heart of hearts and conscience, that this would be wrong for them to administer a sacrament to a person who they felt in their mind was involved in the Cincinnati movement or in communion, then they would have to follow their conscience. That's what I've understood you to say.
Yes.
Now, I talked to Father Jenkins myself personally and said, Father Jenkins, how is it that you can judge and make these opinions yourself over us and withhold the sacraments and do things which we think could be harmful and so forth? He said to me, I'm not judging. We are not judging. We continue to say we're not judging, but in a matter of our own conscience, we believe that it's wrong. And we cannot, in our own conscience, allow ourselves to do this. So it's a matter for them of personal conscience. And I think, at least Father Jenkins told me that, and not an attempt to set him up as a higher authority over our conscience. So I'm confirming only what you conjectured, I think.
Yes, but I think we also have to say that we have to rightly form our conscience as well.
Well, I would agree with that, and that is a good point, and I think this kind of interaction between priests, you and Father Kelly and Father Jenkins, as you mentioned, there may be some pride, and I would agree that there may be some feeling of resentment on your part, that Father Kelly criticized you and made judgment.
Well, I
you may have been wrong on that. And I think maybe he's suffering from some pride himself.
Well, I wanted just to clarify, I didn't feel that, you know, there was any further use of even writing him or giving him any answers because he had already condemned us. Then after the condemnation, he, months later, asked for all these questions. Some of the things that we'd have to try to perhaps write on were based on the validity of the bishops, which he doesn't accept. And, you know, we're not seeing eye to eye on basic points. I thought there was no purpose in writing.
Yes, I see your point. I agree with your point there. It's a difficult one, but the thing that we all worry about is what is actually happening here is that when the priests, traditional priests, are openly squabbling and taking positions, they lose their moral authority with the lay people and with each other.
I would have to certainly agree and also say that I think it's perhaps the best course is a lot of these issues we settle amongst the laity, not amongst the laity, amongst the clergy, because the laity don't need to hear the squabbling back and forth. I know of one issue that came up in 1986 where there was such a public meeting, but clergymen against clergymen, it just got very ugly, and I don't think anyone won except for the devil.
And I appreciate the clergy tonight not having to have it. Mr. Neeson, am I mischaracterizing you, though, to say that if Father Jenkins, Kelly, Fathers Greenwell actually have some qualm of conscience, we have to respect their qualm of conscience just as they have to respect ours? Are you saying that, too, or not? I mischaracterized what you said.
That was my, I think you might mischaracterize a little bit, Jim, because I said to him, I don't feel I'm in sin, and yet you would withhold the sacraments from me. He said, yeah, it's not, I'm not judging you to be in sin. He says, well, I'm just telling you what he said and how his conscience is, but in my mind, in my conscience, I cannot do this because I would be getting scandal and I would be an affecting the condolence. So within my own conscience. So that was his
belief. Okay. Two more, and then I'm going to sum up. I'm sorry, we can stay after this, but I got to say the prayer soon, so people that want to leave can leave. Father Ahern's brother is here, and I think I'm going to slip him in before Father Greenwell. Father Ahern, go. I mean, I just ordained him. That was an illegitimate ordination. Invalid.
Go ahead.
Can I
just make a point here? Defeating the Society of Pius V against Mount St. Michael's. Now, there are other people who do have concerns about Mount St. Michael's. Father Collins, Father Barry, Father Sanborn are not in the Society of St. Pius V and obviously have had differences with Father Kelly somewhere along the line. for that to be the case, and I guess there are other priests also. And I would say that because a lot of the laity do have concerns about Mount St. Michael's, that they would like to see these concerns resolved. Is there any way to have some sort of amicable conference of priests with open minds, not just two warring parties, to actually investigate the matter and try to come to some decision, not based on public meetings or fights or sermons against people or statements printed against people, but actually follow some textbook method of trying to get an answer?
I think what you're asking is, would the clergy at this table meet with Father Kelly and Father Jenkins? Would they be willing to do so?
I think you probably have to throw in some other priests.
And some other priests. Would they be willing to meet? Would they be willing to meet? And then Father,
I think that's what the laity wants. They want this thing resolved.
Yeah, and then
they want Father Kelly proven right, or Mount St. Michael's proven right, or the other one proven wrong. They want a solution.
We're going to have Father Kerfoot respond. Okay, Father Kerfoot has something he wants to say. Then I promise Father Greenwell is going to get the last word, because I appreciate him coming into what is basically hostile territory here tonight. And then I'm going to sum up. Go ahead.
I wanted to respond to that. Over the past several years, ever since Schuckardt's left, anytime there's been a meeting of traditional priests, recent priests there. This last summer, we sponsored a meeting of traditional priests at Mount St. Michael's to do just what you were talking about. And how many outside priests did we have? Seven or eight outside priests from around the country who are not connected with us who came. And we got responses from about 20 more who would have come, but they said that they found out about it too late. This July, there's a group of priests, probably about 25 or 30 priests, who've already agreed to meet in Phoenix to discuss some of these things. And I don't think that we're not willing to talk to people. We're more than willing to talk to people. But you know what happens is we get prejudged, and priests will say, well, we're not going to have anything to do with them meeting them if there's priests and citizens there.
And you also have further that this, like I was saying when I first began this meeting, you also have two sides bumping heads. Radically, you know, you have Father Kelly and Father Jenkins, Father Dolan and Father Chicada. This is what caused the confusion, because you see what you feel a competent priest arguing about an issue, but ultimately, who is the authority that could settle it once and for all? Neither Father Kelly, Father Jenkins, Father Dolan, Father Chicada, none of them are the authority that can settle it once and for all. What we talked about tonight has been pretty much covered by Father Kelly and Father Jenkins in their letters, and Father Dolan and Father Chicada in their letters, vice versa. The first stone, enough said. They all wrap it up, and you know, they still haven't come to an agreement after, I feel, an exhaustive consideration of all things considered. I mean, I don't think they could add anything more or less to what they've already said.
Another correspondent?
Yes, sir.
I think that once again is the case that you have two sides that are prejudged. I think, like the Father Dolan, you kind of prejudged Mount St. Michael's to be legitimate, and Father Kelly, Father Jenkins, have prejudged them to be very wrong. And you're right, you've got two sides bumping heads. We need a buffer zone. We need something where you have competent, independent priests get together in some neutral territory to try to work this out.
Okay.
Although I do have the fear that an independent priest will be hated by both sides.
Okay.
So I want to respond to that and make one other point. I don't think Father Dolan and Father Chicada prejudged us. Matt, maybe you could tell me, did they refuse communion, Father Dolan, at one time? Did he Father Chicada?
It all started in October of 88. We went to
As far as I know, Father Dolan and Father Chicada didn't prejudge us. They came out there to see what's going on.
Yeah.
That's the difference.
They had an open mind. Father Kelly doesn't.
The other point I wanted to make is that sometimes in the letters, and this is an issue that hasn't been touched yet, I just want to address it real quickly. In several of the letters, Father Kelly, I believe, has said, we're in schism because we founded our own church called the Tridentine Latin Rite Catholic Church. The Tridentine Latin Rite Catholic Church was a corporation that was formed because we could not run around Washington State calling ourselves the Roman Catholic Church. because there already is a Washington corporation called the Roman Catholic Bishop of Spokane. If you call yourself Roman Catholic in Washington, the bishop owns you. So we took a corporate name called the Tridentine Latin Rite Catholic Church, which says just what we are. We're Tridentine Latin Rite Catholics. A newspaper reporter picked up on the corporate name. He called us the TLRC. And from that point on, we just got called the TLRC. I have never, ever in my life gone up to somebody and said, hello, my name is Father Lewis. I'm a Latin Rite Catholic priest. I consider myself, and I am a Roman Catholic.
Father, would it have been wiser maybe to say Tridentine Latin Rite movement in retrospect? Would that have been wiser?
I think we have all made mistakes, which we all expect.
Okay. Is that your comment?
Yes, that was a comment.
Okay, Father, I like everybody with their hand up. Father Greenwell, maybe we'll get to you, Kathy. Let me think about you for a minute. Father Greenwell, go ahead.
First of all, I just wanted to point out that it's not just the Society of St. Pius V that refuses communion to the Mount St. Michael's. It's Pius X also and many other independent priests. Secondly, as far as the question of the redoing of the sacraments which carry a character, you cannot just do it simply because the people are uneasy about it. The ones which confer a character, you must do it because of their positive doubt. And you cannot do it otherwise, which is confirmation, holy orders, and baptism. Thirdly, Shane, Sean, I didn't refuse your penance. I asked you to please choose between the two after it had been. I asked you to choose between the two after it had been put in our bulletin. Another layman had told you that you should choose between them. We're not, if you want to go to Shane, we're not.
Okay, Sean, let fathers respond without responding, because we got to wrap this up, okay?
I'm not accusing you of sinning or anything, Shane, but as I'm saying, we have to follow our conscience. And if you want to go to Shane, go absolutely to no one. Sean Murray is sinning by going to Shane.
And the point here is that you're saying that the priests are not trying to judge the internal form. You have to do objectively what you feel is right, or you're violating your own conscience. And I disagree with you on that, but I respect that point.
Jim, I have to respond.
All right, go ahead.
Father, Reverend, when you... You do not accuse me of sin. However, you also said I still have the Catholic faith, yet I was a schismatic. Can I be in schismatic and not in sin? That's the question I have for you. You said I am not in sin. Therefore, if I'm not in sin, or you're not accusing me of sin, then why can't I receive the sacraments? Because you're telling me one thing, you're a schismatic, you're a heretic, and schismatic to me, it's a mortal sin. You cannot save your soul in a schismatic church. If I have not committed a sin, therefore I must be Catholic and I must receive the sacraments.
Yeah,
I have the right to receive them.
Okay, go ahead.
Would you swear to it on the Bible that I called you a heretic in this schismatic?
Okay.
Yeah, I can say implicitly yes.
Okay, now wait,
I'm a communion with schismatics. So that's
okay, we're now down into a personal thing, so we're going to have to cut off.
Can I make a response to one of the points?
Go ahead.
But are you done?
Go ahead. I have one other point.
Go ahead.
As far as the fourth thing, if I claim to be the Pope, would that make me schismatic?
Okay, go ahead.
Did not Schuckardt claim to be the Pope?
Publicly, no.
That's one of the reasons.
Publicly,
no. That's one of the reasons why we got terrifically upset. When I started to hear rumors that he was claiming to be the Pope, I said, what? This is not Catholic.
Sorry. It was, you said that privately.
So okay. He also had pictures. Made, whether they were put up in Mount St. Michael's, the maid who dressed as a pope, he wore the tiara.
No.
Who told you that?
The priest said.
That's not true.
Okay.
But one point, he started with one point. Go ahead.
Please. Thank you, sir.
Go ahead.
Also, did not Schuckardt set up holy days of obligation?
As a good bishop.
Set up holy days of obligation. He called himself Hadrian the Seventh?
No.
Yeah. That's what I have. I could be wrong, and I'm not going to say that I'm absolutely right and you're wrong. But I mean, I do believe what I'm saying.
We're saying it was not right.
Okay.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay, very good. One response on what Father said. You know, when he said that some priest, besides the Society of St. Pius V and Society of St. Pius X, refuse the sacraments, I would say yes and no. There are a number of my parishioners in Omaha and in central Nebraska and in Kansas, when they absolutely cannot go to anyone else, they're fined any Catholic priest, and it's common knowledge. I mean, they let the priest know who's administering the sacraments. They receive the sacraments. So I think we have to make a distinction, even within the Society of St. Pius X, that those distinctions are made. One of the things I could give an example is of like a, who's the priest? Lawrence Bray, up in St. Cloud, Minnesota, Father Bray. He has told people that they cannot go to the Mass and the sacraments of anyone from Mount St. Michael's because of Schuckardt. Do you know Lawrence Bray, Father Lawrence Bray, left Mount St. Michael's in what, 69 or 70? I never met him. He never met me. And he's talking about something that happened, it was 1970, he's talking about something that happened 21 years ago. Schuckardt's been gone, going on 8 years. I wrote him a letter recently and I said, what do you know about Mount St. Michael's now?
Okay, Bob Luck, Catherine, and the camera, he can get some privilege to say something here. Go ahead.
Father Greenwell just poses a question in my mind. He mentioned, he said, not only St. Pius X, St. Pius V, and quite a few of the other priests are refusing communion to St. Michael's group. Now, what about the people that are just friendly to St. Michael's group? Are they also refusing communion to them? Mm-hmm. Well, you mentioned the Bishop Pius X, Pius V, you said there are certain independent groups that are refusing communion.
They're guilty of sin if they're refusing communion.
Michael's group. Now, are they also refusing communion to somebody that's just friendly to their St. Michael's group?
As far as I know, Mr. Buckster has, refusing communion with those who receive it the same communion.
Okay. Okay, that is the answer. Is it about the Pope, Kathy, or not?
No, this is about communion. The law of the church has a certain minimum requirement for giving a communion to a person. They have to be a Roman Catholic in good standing. They can't be a public sinner. Now, a layman cannot be branded with this claim of being a public sinner or out of the church on the basis of whether they agree or disagree with Mount St. Michael. So how can, in any case, these priests refuse communion to laymen? We're just laymen. We don't know all these ins and outs.
Okay. This is kind of moving. I got one more question for the bishop and father. I'm going to then make one final sentence comment. We're going to say a prayer, then we can go on forever. I'm just getting started. As many of you know my schedule, I am ready to roll for another 6 hours if you want. But we have got to shut this down now. And the question is this, and it's my fault for not bringing this up 2 hours ago. There is a lot of testimony of Archbishop Thuc's vacillation of mind. Father gave us his sincere and earnest opinion. Father Quat, who spoke the language, claims that he had a two-hour conversation with Archbishop Thuc in 1983 or so and wanted to become a bishop, but Archbishop Thuc was so incoherent on the papal issue and on other things that he felt he could not become a bishop. Since Father Quat spoke the Vietnamese language, this is a more serious question than it might appear, why is that not, if I trust Father Quat, he spoke to him in Vietnamese for 2 hours and said that he did not have his faculties and his opinion and then foregone becoming a bishop, why is that not a positive doubt?
I think what we have to make a distinction is, was he incoherent to the point where he was babbling, or was he just vacillating on the Pope issue? Because Archbishop Lefebvre has vacillated on certain sense. He says that the conciliar church is heretical, it's schismatic, it's not Catholic. On the other hand, he's saying this man is the Pope. Kneeling at your feet, Holy Father, I beg your paternal blessing. One would maybe think that he was senile too.
If Archbishop Thuc made what appeared to be senile statements, would that be a positive doubt or not? I'm trying to get at the issue of positive doubt versus negative doubt.
No, I don't believe so, because of the fact that at the time of the ordinations occurring, like I had mentioned before with Bishop Moise Carmona, Bishop Carmona said, no crazy man lays hands on me. Thuc was communicable, he was answering, he was speaking theology, he was following the rite of the church afterward, he was interchanging conversation, etc. No crazy man or senile man would be able to do that.
I now close. Oh, Father, go ahead.
We used to be working with a priest by the name of Father Joseph Pino, who's a diocesan priest from Spokane. Quite an older man, about Father Fouhy's age, so he was pretty well along in years. And there were times when Father Pino was senile. But you know what I found was, if you went up and asked him, Father, could you hear a few confessions, something snapped. He said, oh, sure. It was fine. You could hear He could hear those when he was done. He wouldn't even know what day it was. He would go out to say Mass, and he wouldn't miss a beat with the Mass. He was perfect, because I would kneel there and watch him. He was perfect. Did he know he was saying Mass? Yes. Did he know he was a priest? Yes. Did he know anything else about what's going on in the world? Not really. He would mention Paul VI's name in the canon of the Mass. And after Mass, we'd say, you know, Father, Paul VI is a Pope. That's right, he's a Jew. Man's a Jew. I have no doubts about his Mass, because he knew what he was doing when he was a priest. He used a Catholic rite. When he confected the sacrament, he knew what he was doing.
I close with these observations that it should be put in anyone's mind here who hadn't heard it, that in light of the papal crisis, it's a possibility that, like in governments, these last four popes are anti-popes, not because they fell into heresy, but because the elections were stolen. They never were popes from the beginning. That explains the demolition. It's an opinion, but I wanted to just mention that. Number two, and there were invalid elections, therefore. Perhaps the true pope was suppressed, perhaps not. But that is something that I believe is much more believable than that they one Friday at night fell into heresy. Last comment is that I want to state, as a matter of personal opinion, that while we have to do the best we can for now, there can be no resolution to this crisis until the papacy is restored and a true pontiff is operating again. Now, Larry Oancia, for the repose of the soul, let us again stand. Everyone's welcome to stay as long as they want. Let us again stand and say a Hail Mary, an Our Father, a Hail Mary, and a Glory Be. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to
the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
St. Joseph, patron of the universal church,
pray for us.
The Immaculate Conception,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father. Thank you all for maintaining such a high level of conversation.
Really?